Would you please join me with the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
On our agenda first, I asked the fire chief. I talked to him today, and he would like to have a point of personal privilege to speak. So,
sir, hello.
Good evening. My name is Jamie Ayotte. I'm the fire chief, and I thank you very much for your indulgence. I come here this evening following an extremely difficult week for the Hampton Fire family. As you know, we have had the loss of a member. It's given us an opportunity to see something, though, and that is a tremendous outpouring of support from this community. And I would be remiss without thanking everybody involved. There's so many names that go along with it, so I won't be doing that publicly this evening, but I can tell you that we had two opportunities. When we brought Kyle home from New York City, we brought him through the city and through the town, I should say, through the town square. And in doing so, the entire community turned out, and it was so moving for the family and for everybody involved. That outpouring of support really means a lot. There were a lot of firefighters that were there as well, and they saw how much this community cares about their fire department, and that's extremely important too. And on Saturday, which was a very difficult day, with very minimal planning, we saw another tremendous outpouring of support from community members, from the business community here in the town of Hampton. They really just, they made everything almost easy to plan, and that's never an easy thing to talk about either. But, you know, we had 1,600 people show up to pay respects to the family of Kyle Jameson, and that's a tremendous undertaking for anybody. With the support of the business community here in the town of Hampton, they were able to come in, pay their respects. They were fed tremendous food, and they were able to grieve as a group. And I think that that's extremely important. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that their support was absolutely, it just showed the strength and the pillars of this community. And I really thank them. And I thank you very much for your indulgence this evening.
So, thank you.
Thank you.
Now we'll have public comment. Matt Newton.
Matt Newton, 11 Ashbrook Drive. And I'm also president of the Professional Firefighters of Hampton, Local 2664. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak since my topic is not on the current agenda. On May 15th, the fire department, the town, and the state of New Hampshire lost Kyle Jameson to occupational cancer. Since the day he was diagnosed about a year ago, the statement I got from the town was, how can we help? When we found out last Sunday that he had passed away in New York City, the statement had morphed to, what do you need and what can we do? As president of the Firefighters Local, I was tasked with planning a fitting tribute for a fallen brother. The support I received from the town, the fire department, and the business community was overwhelming. I have so many people to thank, I feel like I'm at an Oscar acceptance speech. In addition to the individuals sitting at the table in front of me, selectmen, town manager, I would also like to single out Desi from the 401 for organizing the food, and Fred Shockey from the casino for the incredible venue. All the other individuals who participated in some way, I will be reaching out to you personally to thank you. It was a day we all wish had never come, but we will always remember for the rest of our days. Chris and Liam will forever be a part of the Hampton Fire family. On another note, I'm sure Rusty will bring this up, on June 5th, it's been a tradition for Hampton Falls, and Northampton to have what's called Firefighter Sunday. What happens that day is it rotates around between all the different communities. It was scheduled to be in Hampton Falls this year. But with the situation going on, we said, you know what? We'll take it. Well, Kyle's name is going to be on the memorial at the High Street Cemetery. And every single name of all the departed members from those three communities will be read. And it's done every year, and it's done in remembrance of those people that came before us and gave their lives eventually. I think there was only one or two that were in line of duty. But to me, I really do think that Kyle was a line of duty. We don't get cancers any other way, at least not for someone healthy like him. That's all. Thank you very much for your indulgence, and thank you to the community of Hampton. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Bob Ladd, Village District Commissioner, 7 Cutler Avenue. I'm here to publicly thank you folks for the support you've been giving for the Sandcastle event, which we sponsor every summer, and to express Mr. Grady's sincere thanks for all your cooperation. He is out of town and unable to be here tonight. But the town, state, village district coming together in this project is really quite encouraging. In fact, so much so, at the end of this event, we've added another day of activity, which will be on July 6th. On that day, the town and the village district and the state have come together to form a day which we're basically calling a tween fest or summer games in Hampton. The targeted age group is 8 to 14 years of age. This is a group we've identified as underserved in terms of our activities. And we're doing this in cooperation with the rec department of the town, which has taken a very active participatory role in this, and with the state, which is very cooperative also. So I just want to thank all involved.
Thank you, Bob. Anybody else? Senator.
Thank you. Nancy Stiles, One Hayden Circle, Hampton. Senator for District 24, as well as Chair of the Senate Transportation Committee. And I saw on your agenda this evening that you're going to be talking about the sidewalks again. And I know that's been a very difficult issue for you in the past, but I'm hoping that we can find a smooth way to get through the process. I will share with you that the engineering for Route 1A has been moved up in the 10-year plan to 2019 and 20, so it's been moved up 2 years. The department was very agreeable to do that. I spoke with the commissioner and shared with her some of your, what I thought your concerns were anyway, and that was with the plowing of the sidewalks. And she told me that she would be very glad to enter into an agreement with you to do whatever they could to help. She wants to support the effort by you taking on the sidewalks, and so she's very glad to do that. I asked her how many miles of roads they had to plow, and when they have a snowstorm, they have to plow 8,988 lane miles. So they're pretty busy plowing the roads when we have a storm, but they would gladly work out a schedule with you so that if you plow the sidewalks, they will pick up the snow and take it out. So I would encourage you, if that's a direction that you're thinking of going, to have that conversation with her and begin an agreement as soon as possible so that you know that that's in place, in writing, agreed by both parties well ahead of time. The other thing I wanted to share with you is I know someone asked me, I know this isn't on your schedule, but someone asked me about the painting of the sidewalks. And the painting of the sidewalks in Hampton on Route 1A is the only place on 1A that the state does that. So I'm pleased that at least they do cooperate with you in that area. And they plan to be doing that probably sometime in the next couple of weeks because they've been busy striping 93 to get that done. So if there's anything that I can do to help facilitate anything, meetings or conversations, I would be more than happy to help. Okay?
I think we'll be calling you.
Thank you.
Anybody else from the public? Mr. Rice.
Thank you. Good evening. Fred Rice, 15 Heather Lane. I'd also like to make a few comments about the sidewalks. I've been involved with that subject about as long as most anybody in town that doesn't live at the beach. Started with the Faye Spofford Thorndike study started in 2002. I endorsed their findings, which did call for replacement of the sidewalks, replacement of Ocean Boulevard and upgrading. I worked with Senator Stiles. She carries, as usual, most of the weight, but I worked with her on getting this on the 10-year plan. And a couple of years ago, or maybe not that long ago, not too long before he left, I had a one-on-one conversation with the previous commissioner, Commissioner Clement, And he, just like the present commissioner, was very, very helpful in trying to reach as much accommodation as they possibly could on this issue. I asked him a number of specific questions regarding the sidewalks and the road down there and the rebuild, and we kind of went through it step by step. Yes, they were willing to rebuild the whole thing if it's on the 10-year plan. Yes, they were willing to consider as part of that design, excuse me, a sloped sidewalk rather than a curbed sidewalk, which might invite personal injury and so forth. They were more than willing to turn it over, the ownership over to the town. Their highways, just like the crosswalks that the senator mentioned, there are no sidewalks on state highways, which is why their policy is there. I think Ocean Boulevard is the one exception. There might be one or two other very small sections of state highway that have a sidewalk on them, but nowhere else do they maintain them. So they're trying to keep their policy uniform throughout the state so they can do the same thing in all places. They are, however, I found this with the previous commissioner, and I have no reason to think anything different would come about with the current commissioner on the arrangements for the plowing and so forth. I had a similar conversation with Commissioner Clement regarding that. I think that if we look at the negotiation that's coming up on this, we had a town manager, several town managers ago, who always used to say, the best negotiation is when both parties come out of it equally unhappy. That means they each have to give up a little bit of something.
Yeah.
And I think that's true in this one, too. What is the state giving up? They're giving up a pretty valuable piece of property, all that sidewalk. They're willing to give up as much as 15 feet wide, perhaps. All the way down there, that would come over to the town. The town, in turn, would have to maintain, well, they'd have to plow it. Maintenance, you know, look at Route 1 from High Street North that was put in back when I was a selectman. It was in like 99, I think it was finally put in. And we're just now starting to see some of the wear and tear. But the town hasn't had to spend much money on maintenance of Route 1 because it was a brand new road. I think you'll see the same thing down there. There's not going to be a lot of out-of-pocket cost other than the cost of a snowplow. I know that the town manager has referenced the Americans with Disabilities Act, that you have to clear ways from the stores out to the right-of-way. And I don't know how many stores are actually open down there. Perhaps some of the merchants down there that are there all winter long. I try not to go down there too much in the winter. I don't have any business down there during the winter. But I think maybe Bob Preston or Tom McGuirk could cite the number of places down there. And if you passed an ordinance that required them to clear that out to the right of way, that would take care of a good bit of it. But I think that what would the thing that you would gain from this is a tremendous increase in visitors that come here and say, gee, this is the last piece of all of this puzzle they've been putting together over the last 10, 15 years, and it will be a greater place for them. And I think we will see a result, an increase in commerce, an increase in tourists, an increase in income for the businesses that pay the tax base in this town and so forth. So I think that if you would approach this on the positive side, yes, there is an agreement in there, but the agreement was done in 1933, I believe it is. Is that correct? 33. That's older than I am. That's old. So
you sure you weren't there?
Yeah, I heard about it the next day. No, but you know, old agreements like that must grow with the times. At that time, in 1933, there were still Model A's and even maybe some Model T's on the road. The traffic volume was different.
The chairman, I can't hear.
Yeah, can we give him some respect and allow him to hear him to speak?
There were some pretty old cars on the road then, and the traffic was lighter. The beach was a totally different place. Now it has grown. And perhaps in the best interest of the people who come here to our town, in the best interest of the businesses here in town, maybe it's the appropriate time to think about renegotiating this contract in a positive way so that both parties, instead of coming out equally unhappy, they come out equally happy. So I hope that you will vote in favor of a good agreement with the state. And as with Senator Stiles, is there anything I can do to assist on this? As a go-between, as a messenger, as a whatever, dealing with the folks up in Concord, I'd be more than happy to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Somebody else speak? Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Charles Locke. I'm a resident here, and I'm speaking for people that live on Winneconnet and all the side streets that have children that come down to the seawall. And we've had a situation where there's been a boat on a trailer and a big camper, and for some reason they're in the legal right because it's registered. However, I found a loophole. Loophole is where that camper is parking, it's blocking where the pump house is. Is making it hazardous to the workers that pull out of there. I would suggest that the town would approach them, they live on Viking Street, and would ask them to please park in the town parking lot for the mothers, fathers who want to bring their children down to go to the beach, which is our beach, North Beach. And I also would request that the state would agree in front of the ocean, big yellow building, if they could give up 6 spots for residential parking to make it easier for the moms that come bringing their carriages down with all the children. That's it.
So you're talking at the pump house on the end of Winneconnet Road is where this boat
yes,
can camp around?
Yes, it's been there for a long time. And I've called the police. I've came here, and apparently he's just parking there.
I will tell you, I was approached not by this gentleman but by another woman. And this week, and I told her to put it all in writing to send a letter to Mr. Welch. But there's 2 vehicles, the boat and whatever else. The people park them there more than 24 hours at a time. They stay there for weeks. And the law is that there's not supposed to be anyone on the parked on the streets after 1 o'clock. Isn't that right, Mr. Welch?
That's only during snow plowing time. But yes. I can see that the town manager is writing this down, and I'm sure he's... Yeah.
Well, you're going to be hearing from, because I know this other...
We'll take a peek in the morning.
Yeah, well, this has been there. There's been complaints that have been made before. I told them to document it at the police department, and I can't think of who it was now, but this is a problem that several people have mentioned that live around there.
Well, at the condos, there are no guest parking, and so yeah, people do come to park there, but
the condo,
he's taking up 6 spots.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, summer's coming, it's not fair to the parents that want to bring their children down. And that's another reason why I'd like to suggest that the state could turn over at least 6.
That has nothing to do with this board here.
Yeah.
But those spots are never used. I live
all
here.
The state.
That you have to deal with the state, but we will have the town manager take a look at this tomorrow.
I thank you very much, Mr. for the people of Winneconnet.
I've also had several inquiries about this gentleman's vehicles. I've talked to him twice. He told me he was going to move them. The trailer is gone as of this morning, but there's still 3 there. And I did let him know that it's been cause for enough complaints by neighbors on Viking and neighbors on Winneconnet that I was going to bring it up today under new business. So okay. It's definitely, it's going to be an ongoing issue.
Thank you for bringing that up. Is there anybody else that would like to speak at public comment?
Norman Sobertig, 17 Tide Mill Road, for Rational Taxpayers of Hampton. This will be the last time I'm approaching the board on the subject of encumbrances. I'd like to speak to the comments made by Attorney Gerald last Monday. And I have written them down, and I will give them to you at the end of my short presentation. Section 718-3A of the purchasing policy states that all purchases, supplies, materials, and services, including professional services, the cost of which is estimated to exceed $15,000, shall be allowed only after competitive sealed bids or sealed written professional proposals have been solicited. Section 718-3C includes the language, if the purchase does not comply with the purchasing policy, it requires a waiver voted by the Board of Selectmen before action can be taken by a department of purchase. 718-3C was an amendment introduced in 2013 by Selectman Bean in reaction to past problems. The town attorney said last week, I believe it was implicit in the vote that was taken on 12-21-15 to approve encumbrances that this policy was waived and was not going to be required to be followed to implement these encumbrances. The motion that was approved at 12-21-15 that the town attorney was referencing to is Selectman Bean motion to take $444,500 in the budget for the purchase of the above mentioned equipment, seconded by Selectman Bridle, vote 500. The only reference to the purchasing policy in the entire discussion of the $444,500 encumbrance was the town manager commenting they would have to sign the POs by December 31. It is worth noting that immediately preceding the 12-21-15 discussion of the encumbrances, there was a legitimate purchasing policy waiver approved by for an unrelated purchase of a Scarify with the following motion. Selectman Bridle motion to approve the purchasing policy waiver section 718-4B for bid 2015-011 Scarify, seconded by Selectman Woolsey, vote 500. The point is that town officials know what they need to do to construct a proper purchasing policy waiver motion. Since when does the Board of Selectmen do business on an implicit in the vote manner? The town attorney also stated there is no state law that requires competitive bidding. That arises only if the board or a town charter authorizes that. While we agree that there is no explicit language in the statute, there is in fact case law that addresses the subject, specifically Girard Construction versus City of Manchester. In its declaratory judgment for this case, the New Hampshire Supreme Court stated, municipalities, like private parties, generally are free to contract without the requirement of advertisement and competitive bidding. Where such provisions are enforced, however, strict compliance with the municipal scheme, the purchasing policy, is required. The court goes on to state, we are buttressed in our view by an analysis of the purpose of requiring competitive bidding. These procedures serve to invite competition, guard against favoritism, improvidence, extravagance, fraud, and corruption, and secure the best work or supplies at the lowest price practical. To the police department video encumbrance, the chief stated on January 25th, 2016, that he had not even started looking into that requirement, stated he didn't know how many cameras he needed. There was no spec of what the vendor was going to provide in 91A information review. To RSA 327, how can there be a legally enforceable obligation if there's no definition of what the vendor is to provide in return for $110,000 in the purchase order? There was no signature on the purchase order. To the fire department phone system, December encumbrances, the town attorney stated last week the replacement of the fire telephone system acceptance was in fact not communicated. That being the case, why is 2015 PO 15-446 for a $27,000 fire department phone system contained on the January 23rd, 2016 purchase order list attached to the 215 final pass expense statement? It was not a legal encumbrance. Of greater concern is why the $27,000 encumbrance for the phone system is still included in the fire department communications replacement equipment encumbrance line item in the April 2016 expenditure report. The April report was distributed to the selectmen less than 2 weeks ago. It appeared to us that the town attorney's intent last week was to defend the actions of the town manager, finance director, and board of selectmen related to the $444,000 encumbered on December 25th. While we understand and accept that the town attorney may receive direction from the board of selectmen, we believe his clients are ultimately the citizens of the town of Hampton. In our opinion, the presentation by the town attorney last week was designed to put a town officials in a positive light and mislead the public. An objective legal opinion looking out for the interests of citizens of Hampton would have been more appropriate. Before embarking on a course of making changes that would weaken or reduce the benefits to the taxpayers from the purchasing policy by increasing the dollar threshold or reducing the required number of bidders, Wouldn't it make more sense to conduct an investigation analysis to get to the bottom of why Hampton is having so much trouble getting three qualified bidders on projects exceeding $15,000? This is all, thus far, all we heard is off-the-cuff opinions of the town manager and some of the selectmen. One final note, every time I come here and make a presentation, Phil Bean gets up, walks out of the room. I think it's classless and absolutely rude. I would show him the respect if he was engaged in any business that I was conducting, and I think it's no way to treat a citizen, and it's just appalling to me. I have a copy of this to you, for you. If we go to court and we had that option, either Superior Court or DRA, we would believe we'd prevail, but it would be a hollow victory because all we would create would be the reversal of these transactions, and they would then be put into this year's operating budget to be funded. It's not the specific items that we're concerned about. It's the process and the system of the purchasing policy. And as stewards of the town's resources, you have to challenge the process and make sure it's being followed properly. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
I wish you a great Memorial Day weekend.
Anybody else would like to speak? Anybody else public comment? Let me see, make sure there's nobody else first. You've already been up once, Mr. Rice.
Different subject.
Yes, gentleman right behind you.
John Welch, 1 Viking Street. I'm the owner of the camper and the trailer. I moved the trailer today. Fred Welch, I'll be moving the camper tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. It's good to see you, John.
Yeah.
Take care.
Anybody else would like to speak?
Just a thought. It was mentioned just a moment ago. On behalf of American Legion Post 35, I would like to invite all of the selectmen, the town staff, all of our elected officials to participate in the Memorial Day Parade next Monday at 11:30. We'll be forming up right behind the fire station over here. And it's been a while since we've had a preponderance of selectmen there. I hope we can see you all there. We'll look forward to it. It's a good day to pay tribute to some people who gave a lot. Thank you very much.
Fred, I would just like to say I go every year, but this year I can't go. I go every year, you know.
Okay, since you've been there, you got to get 4 substitutes. Thank you.
Is there anybody else for public comment? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the board for announcements and community calendar.
I don't have anything, Mr. Chairman.
I'm set. Oh, yes, I'm sorry that Mr. Silberdick won't be coming to any more of these public comments and meetings, and I wish him the best wherever he's going. And went to a conservation bake sale, plant sale, water barrel sale this weekend, right here on the town grounds, and it was magnificent. The Conservation Commission, they really do a fantastic job, and it echoes firefighter to comment. The outstanding business owners and elected officials that are in this audience tonight, and our good friend Mr. Welch is going to move his stuff. It's a great community with great people, and I just wanted to share that with you, my wonderful experience this weekend out there at the town grounds, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Mr. Griffin.
Yes, I would just like to say that, again, I go every year, and I really enjoy it, and I hope that more people will be able to go. I go to the one at 8 o'clock that starts at the
statue.
The statue. It's always fabulous. And then I always go to the one at 11:30 uptown. And it amazes me, the things you think about. You see all those people. It helps me remember my parents that were in the military. And I find it's really nice. And it's... Tonight we're going to be talking about ADA accessible, and it's for many of these people coming back from Iraq and Iran and wherever else, Syria, and I think we really have to pay more attention to being ADA accessible for all our sidewalks all over town. Thank you.
And as Mr. Newton said, June 5th, be a lot warmer. Is Fireman's Memorial Sunday. They will be meeting at the Uptown Fire Station at 9 o'clock in the morning, and I would encourage any of our local citizens who want to go out. It's a small little, pretty simple ceremony. They march up to the cemetery. They have a little thing there, and they come back to the fire station for coffee and conversation. So along with our regular Memorial Day stuff next Monday, the following Sunday, they do have Fireman's Memorial Sunday. Again, to the fire chief and firefighter Newton, this town suffered a great loss. And we are all very proud of our citizens in this town, how they acted over the past week. So, thank you. Consent agenda. We have the Hampton Beach Village District request for the town assistance for the 16th annual Beach Master Plan Sand Sculpting Competition. We have a parade and public gathering for Save One Animal Rescue Adoption on 6/4/16. We have cemetery deeds. We have a request of no objection of service of alcohol for Pachanga LLC, Mexican Grill, 275 Ocean Boulevard. We have Hawker's Peddler's License. Do I have a
motion? I'm moving the agenda.
We have a motion?
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Thank you.
I move the minutes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? We have May 16th minutes.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Next thing is appointments. We have Ellen Lavin, treasurer for the 2016 TAM notes.
Good evening.
Good evening, Ellen.
How are you?
Just fine. How are you?
Great. I don't have the notes with me tonight. Bond counsel asked actually last year that I come and get permission to borrow for a TAN. You should have the paperwork in front of you, which is the response from Provident for a $4 million non-revolving municipal line of credit. So what I do is I borrow as needed, and then working with finance, we pay it back. So between now and the end of the year is $4 million. The interest rate is 2.5% based on Federal Home Loan Bank of Boston. So from here, it goes to bond counsel, who is Divine Melamed. They have a list of things that Christy needs to put together or I need to put together. They want to make sure that it was voted at town meeting. They have a copy of the warrant showing that we, or you asked for permission to borrow. Cash flow proving that we may need the money at some point in time. Last year I didn't borrow, but depending on what we're doing or if there's any construction in town, I may have to. So I'm just here tonight to get permission to have bond counsel move forward.
I'll make that motion.
Motion. Second. Any questions?
What is the exact motion?
Motions to authorize the town treasurer with the approval of both selectmen to borrow up to $4 million in TAN authorizations.
I make that motion.
Just, if you could just clarify what that's for, so the public knows that you're not borrowing $4 million.
No, I'm not borrowing $4 million. What happens from time to time, if the town of Hampton does construction, that we have in the past, between, I don't know when the warrant is going out for tax collection. I'm assuming June 1st, because usually it's July 1. So sometimes between May 31 and July 1, we run a little bit short of cash. So, you know, if we're buying new fire trucks or we're buying new equipment or whatever. So I may have to go out and borrow. Last year, as I said, I didn't borrow. At the end of the year, we're talking maybe doing some construction with sewer. So there may be a lag between when the money comes in from borrowing, so I have to have a little bit of a cushion there.
Right. And could you just explain TAN? So, you know, because people, we often speak in terms like that, and the public's watching, and they say, I don't know what that means.
It's a tax anticipation note.
Okay.
Meaning we're anticipating taxes to come in July 1, and there may be a shortfall for 2 or 3 weeks.
Thank you.
And this is something that's done regularly all through the years. Last year was one.
Every year.
Didn't have.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we did receive your handout. Could you just briefly discuss the terms and what banks you bid out?
I did not bid out to any other banks. In the past, I have gone to Citizens and I have gone to TD. And what they want me to do, at Provident, if I need $500,000, they'll give it to me. At Citizens, if I wanted $4 million, they want me to borrow it all at once.
Gotcha. And the rate?
The rate is 2.5%.
Thank you. I have no more questions, Mr. Chairman.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And then I'll be...
Oh. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, this is another one of those instances where the town purchasing agreement doesn't fit, because she'd have to take all $4 million instead of just $500,000.
Correct. So sometimes it's actually what I usually do is go to the bank after town meeting. So when I know if we're going to be buying equipment or whatever, and if the it's going to come up between now and the 1st of July, because there may be a shortfall. And a lot of our notes that we've had over the past years are all due in March and April. So it's there's somewhat of a shortfall.
Okay.
But
thank you all.
Great. I'll be back in a couple of weeks with the note.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next one we have is Kathleen Murphy, Superintendent of SAU 90. And I was surprised to see her here tonight.
Did you hold on?
Yeah.
Yeah, we did.
We did. Because I thought she was at the heroin.
She was. Nathan sends his apologies. He's not feeling well, and he was going to make the presentation with Keith, and so I'm filling in for Nathan. And yes, we have a forum going on heroin opiate crises. It's the second forum that the school district has sponsored, so we have a great crowd up there and some good speakers. And the best part is we videotaped it and we'll be up on Channel 13 so that anybody who can't make it, like yourselves, will have a chance to see it. It's very informative. So.
Well, glad to have you here tonight.
Yeah, thanks. I was glad to be here. It's always a pleasure to be with Keith and to share some of the things that we're doing in the district. I think on your agenda first is our request to have representation to our Hampton Academy Project Advisory Committee. As in the past, you've appointed someone. We found that to be very valuable. It's a great way for us to share information and for that person to be the conduit for information to you. So I would hope that you would consider that as a board and have a representative on that committee for us.
I think it's very valuable, and as we know that Ms. Woolsey was on there before. And so I don't know if you're interested.
When are the meetings?
Their meetings, they've...
The meetings meet, we meet once a month. It's usually the meeting that's not the planning board meeting,
the fourth
Wednesday of the month, and we meet at Hampton Academy in the library at 6:30, and we try to be very concise and be out by 8 o'clock.
I'll volunteer for that if you're looking for somebody.
Okay. I mean, if you'd like to
Thank
do
you,
that,
Jim.
That's fine. Anybody make a motion?
So moved.
Seconded?
I'll second it.
All's in favor? Jim, you're it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Popular.
Thanks. Thank you. The second piece to our to being here tonight has to do with a project, our Safe Routes to School project. As many of you know, the school district has been engaged in Safe Routes to School for a number of years now. We've been doing Walk to School. You probably see all the school kids walking on some days. It reminds me of the mother hen and all the chicks behind them. It's an incredible experience. We also have been doing bike rodeos, and we also have assemblies for the kids in school, learning good rules around safety coming to and from school. But we stepped it up 2 years ago, and we got a second grant that allowed us to do a planning grant. And that planning grant allowed us to identify areas throughout the town that were could be problematic to students coming to school safely. We were encouraging student walkers as well as bike riders, so those two things we kept in mind. The committee then held several forums in the community. We actually held one here on a Saturday morning, and we held one in the evening for parents, and we received a great deal of input. And from that and the committee's study, and we also had a planning group that helped us identify areas around our schools, and they put together a report that had approximately 30 different sites in and around the schools. including the high school, that we should look at. From there, the committee narrowed it down to five sites in the town, and brought those five recommendations to our school board. Our school board has been reviewing this on an ongoing basis, and they have identified their first project. Their first project is a project that is over at the center school on Winneconnet. You have a handout in front of you, and I'm going to pass the baton to my friend here, and he's going to review that project with you.
Okay, good evening. This should be, it's a very important project, but this should be fairly easy to digest. The improvement is going to be at Center School at the crosswalk. It was a priority of the school board to move forward with that project to improve the sidewalk. The project on Winneconnet Road obviously is in front of Center School for those folks at home, and also across from this building in Toll Avenue. We met with Public Works and their team of with the road agent, Jen, Chris, Frank, Fred was there, and Jamie, Nathan, and myself. So we went over the proposal, which you're going to see, and the back of the plan is a kind of the schematic for the project. But to describe the project, we're going to construct a concrete island, which is actually divided through the middle with the crosswalk. There's an area of refuge for pedestrians should they get stuck in the middle of the road. Granite curbing and appropriate signage. If you want to look quickly at the signage, it's on the last page. It's the look of a pentagon, which is a solar-powered light with a push button, and that gets into the details of how that will operate. When the original design was for a raised table, but the concern for the raised table, if we go with the places of refuge, we won't need to raise the table. Have a raised table there. A lot of the conversation around that was that it really isn't to slow people down, it's to get people to pay attention. People go slowly past here, it's just a lot of traffic. What you will see is that the plan, it tries to funnel the traffic heading east and funnel the traffic heading west with the granite in the center. I do want people to know that we are still going to have a crossing guard there. So every morning and every afternoon when the kids are coming and going from school, there'll be a crossing guard there to aid the students. And anybody knows that Larice is a very brave woman that gets out there every day and takes on the Fords, the Chevys, the Toyotas.
Is she the one that pushes the button or the other people?
Well, she probably wouldn't use the button when she's out there. She'll have her stop sign. But when people want to cross, when it's unattended with a crossing guard, they would push the stop, the button. So what we're looking for is it's a fully funded project from the Hampton School District. Look at this like it's an off-site improvement. You know, we'll work very closely with Public Works, the town manager. We're going to put out an RFP. I'm sure we get your blessing to move forward with the project, of course. We're working with the engineers that designed this project, worked all along on Safe Routes to School, Greenman and Pedersen. Right now, the school board has approved the funding for the project. We've engaged the engineering, so we started working on that. We're waiting for approval from the selectmen to go the next step with the engineers. They're ready. We're going to do the bidding in June, and we plan to do the project in this summer, upcoming summer, and when school starts, it'll be installed. Now, The other thing is that we have the town clock now that sets on the lawn now there, which because we're kind of creating a little clock park there. And this actually will dignify the clock that much more because we're going to have 8-foot sidewalk in front of it. It's an 8-foot sidewalk on the other side of the street in front of the, between the parking lot here and Toll Avenue. And that way we can always put a truck on it to plow it. I know you're going to talk about sidewalks later on. We all love sidewalks. So I would like to ask you folks if you would kindly approve us to do our off-site improvement on Winneconnet Road. Thank you.
So moved.
I'll second it.
Any questions?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I don't have a question. Just I think it's a great idea because I think Hampton is terribly unpedestrian friendly. It's awful, and I think to get more kids to walk to school and ride their bikes to school is a real positive, and get less buses out there. But I mean, I think anything that makes it safer going to school is really great. And I'm sure the people in the back thank you for all your positive sidewalk talk.
Just a quick comment. We have been in contact with the Department of Transportation, who oversees this program, Safe Routes. So we're looking at funding. The funding for Safe Routes projects, of course, has dried up. But there are other monies available that will be dedicated to schools around safety that will probably come to fruition sometime in January. So we'll stay on top of that because there are other projects that the board has in mind for that very reason that you just described, Jim, safe walking and safe riding their bikes to school and improving passages to and from the three schools.
And probably, I'll go out on a limb here, probably will be High Street at Marston Way will probably be the next push to improve that crosswalk there.
I would just like to say today, I was headed here, and all of a sudden, it appeared to be a student, although those are young students there, aren't they?
They're kindergarten and first, second grade.
This kid was walking with a backpack on, and he, I was surprised he just didn't walk to the crosswalk that's there now, but he didn't. He just walked right to go down the road at, what is that, Toll Road?
Toll Avenue.
Yeah. And is this going to be accessible to that, or do you think that will be in?
Well, Fred helped us paint some blue stripes on the crosswalk we have there because we try to have everybody follow the blue lines across the front door at Center School. If you look at the diagram on the this diagram here, we're going to have granite curbing from the east side of Toll Ave to the parking lot exit of Town Hall. Mm-hmm. Okay, and on the other side, the granite is going to go from the west side of the beginning of the bus loop on the inside loop to the exit of the bus loop. We are adding a little peninsula that will clear up the delineation between Ross Colony's driveway and the exit to the bus exit at Center School. We try to train the children to use the crosswalks. We should actually do a PSA. You should always walk against traffic if there is no sidewalk so you can see cars oncoming. But they work very hard to train the kids. Kids are kids. We all need to be aware that they're out there and to be aware that we're a community with lots of children that are walking around, riding their bikes. The weather is beautiful, and they don't have their fall experience. In the fall, they get more experience. Kids are growing up. They get a little braver. They're learning. So it's good that you're paying attention when you're driving, Rick.
Yes, I wasn't driving. I said, look at that kid.
Well, the person driving you.
I have followed all of this on your meetings. I've followed, you know, the reports and saw your presentation, and I think it's a really good thing. And I think that this probably, because it is such a big production there, that people should get the message, and I would hope that the police would stop people if they saw them not going there, and, you know, give them a little lesson.
Yes.
You know, how they really should do it. But
police department's been very supportive, and they park a cruiser out there very frequently.
Yeah. So. And I think this makes a lot of sense where the town hall is here and everything. Maybe, though, when you do the other one down there, that it could be so that it goes along with the sidewalks where people might be walking, you know, where the natural path of where they want to go.
Right.
This kid was... Are there sidewalks on both sides of Toll?
One side.
One side.
One side, and it's on the right, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was walking...
On the left side, going from...
On the west side.
There's the white west side. On the west side.
Well, he didn't know where he was going then. He was walking right down the middle of the street.
I know. He's probably heading home, though.
Yeah.
That was a student that wasn't from Hampton, I'm sure.
But it was probably someone coming home. It looked like more of a teenager.
Yeah.
I think this is a great plan. You guys have been working on this for a while. It kind of flows right in with Experience Hampton and one of their projects they have this year with working on crosswalk lighting in the town. I just want to make sure, and I'm sure the answer is yes, that you talked about the 8-foot sidewalk on the north side.
Yes.
And that is all in the right of way.
Correct.
So it won't affect the person that owns that house.
It shouldn't. The gentleman behind me. No.
I'm just checking. I'm sure he's all in for this. So I just wanted to make sure that was. I think it's an excellent project. I applaud you guys for doing this. I know yes. Safe Roots has been a long time coming. A lot of work has got spent on it, and we continue to make kids safer in this town, the better off we are. But I have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
I especially appreciate the way that you've gone to get the grants and worked on those grants. I think that's very key.
Well, they know we're looking, so... I hope we'll get
now,
some money.
Did you find any problem with getting grants because Hampton's such a wealthy town? That's what I've been told here around, that we don't get grants because we're such a wealthy town.
In this particular grant, there are other grants that means something, but in this particular grant, as well as a grant we just got from Homeland Security, our wealth did not matter. What mattered was our need.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and I know that in Stratum, they just got a $600,000 sidewalk grant from nowhere, and they're much wealthier than Hampton. Thank you.
We'll keep at it. Thank
Again,
you very
thank
much
you very
tonight.
Much for your
thank
support
you. Appreciate
to
it.
The schools.
Thank you. Next one, we have Chris Jacobs, Public Works Director, and Jen Hale, Deputy Public Works Director.
Good evening.
Good evening.
The item that I believe I have before you is, and this stems from 2 weeks ago when we met concerning the Church Street Force Main Sewer possible relocation. I think the request at that time was to bring forth the contract and try and figure out how I would pay for it for this year. Put together a memo, released it through Fred's office on the 19th. It's a master contract with Wright-Pierce Engineering for $219,100. I broke it out into its three proportioned items, such as land surveying and subsurface exploration. Those are things that would have to be done. Don't smile. Would have to be done right off the bat. The engineering is going to take somewhere around 6 months. That's based upon the schedule they gave us before. And how I would pay for that is I still have $39,852 in my engineering line. It started off at $40,000. My sewer access fee account stands at about $93,364, plus or minus. I don't track it every day. There's permits that come in and out every day. There's $10,000 in the wastewater treatment plant engineering line. I'm confident I can use that money because there's also $90,000 that was approved 2 years ago for a facility study. So if they have an engineering question, it's more than likely going to get covered under the facility study. We're expecting another $31,000 in the sewer access account through the summer. The number of homes over on Drake Side Road, things of that nature. As you know, these things are still popping a lot down at the beach. All those projects generate funds into that sewer access account. And I would like to, it would be a pitch at this point, that $50,000 of this, because the project's going to extend into 17, I'd actually use next year's engineering line to pay for that, and that gives me a total funding line of $224,316. In summary, it's all those little accounts that allow me to, or allow us to move forward with this project, be under the current design, acting responsibly, addressing the state's needs to see that we're moving forward on this. That's what I had. Questions?
Questions from the board?
Well, not necessarily a question per se, but again, we're going against the purchasing policy, so I think we just need to make sure that we document why. And I mean, I know you did here, but I think that maybe we should state so.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Wright Pierce was selected under an RFQ policy 2 years ago, RFQ standing for Request for Qualifications. We went out for professional services for various firms that, in this case, it was for the Church Street Pump Station. They were selected, interviewed, picked up the project, and they had actually done the preliminary design 3 years earlier than that. They were the ones that were able to bring the what was anticipated to be a $4.5 million project in for something like $2.3 million. And it's working. It's working excellently. To me, you shouldn't jump ship middle of the stream, because these two force mains are going to be tied literally to the pumps that they specified. They have all the pump design data. They have all the flow data. If they proceed forward with this contract for the force main, you can be assured that the Church Street pump station using these force mains, things would be, they would work. There would be a smooth flow or a smooth transition. The other thing that Jennifer and I have been discussing the last couple of days is the ability to have them answer for us as this project moves forward. What future capacity are they building into it? Is it a means of bigger pipes, multiple pipes, or it sounds like it's going to come back to, if the beach kept growing and growing at the rate it's been growing, that it would probably be an upgrade in a pump to increase the speed or the velocity of the fluid through the pipe. So that's why in this particular project it would make sense, because it is physically connected to Church Street, and you have already pre-vetted them for this project or a portion of this project.
Okay. Any other questions?
Sure. I'm all set. Thank you.
Yeah, Chris, just maybe an explanation of why we're doing this now, because people might be watching and saying, well, we haven't even voted on a warrant article to approve, you know, putting the pipes in there. So why would we, just for the public, why would we be doing this now, doing the study?
Well, there's some risk of just sitting on our hands, so to speak, and waiting for the next shoe to drop. Too many colloquialisms. But the reality is we do need to move forward. It doesn't make sense to keep your two garden hoses underneath the marsh where I can't get to them to clean them or to inspect them, due to their length and also the inaccessibility of being under the marsh. So I think we showed with the matrix we do need to move forward with this. Why move forward at this time? In my conversations with the state, I've asked them, well, let me go with my board and work with my board. 2 weeks ago when I was there, I said, I'll call you on Tuesday morning. Let you know what the board said. Tomorrow morning, I have a prearranged phone call with the enforcement officer. They want to know that we're moving forward towards a solution so that We have a possible solution should a force main break again. They don't want us sitting on our hands. They want us to take reasonable steps forward in a time manner that we can handle to resolve what is a potential issue, i.e. if another discharge into the bay. That's what they want us to do.
And this will also provide documents that will be ready if the town therefore votes to approve the project, will be ready to go. We will have bid documents, be able to get it out there, get the price on the street, and the design will be done.
Right. It'll also give a better explanation of exactly what
and
you're going to do.
So and a more refined cost. I mean, you're going to know what you're building. It's
yeah,
not
right now we have, she's Jennifer's correct, we just have a price per foot. These are typically as things of cost. But if you, as you go through this design process, you get to the 50% or 70% design mark, they'll be able to eliminate unknowns and refine their estimate down tighter so that when we do prepare a warrant article and have to finalize a number, let's say by January, we have a much better number to finalize and to bring forth.
Thank you.
I like the fact that I read your report that you're taking your time and doing it correctly so that you don't have to rush into it and that you can get the best deal for the taxpayers of Hampton.
Would agree. Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Pending further discussion, I would move that we accept the town contract with Wright Pearson in the amount of $219,000 and $219,100 and no cents, and authorize the findings is attached in a separate memo. That memo was incorporated into this document provided by the Public Works Director, dated 19 May 2060, to Fred Welsh, the town manager, from Chris Jacobs, the Director of Public Works, the subject of which is the funding sources for the Wright Pierce contract project, the Church Street Force Main Sewer Relocation. Sir.
Have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
I just wanted to say one more thing. That, you know, when I refer, you're not rushing into it by having a special meeting and just trying to, you know, do something too fast. I think you're thinking about it methodically, and I think that's important. Thank you.
Do we have to make note that this is not according to the purchase policy?
I would.
So would you add that to yours?
That the bid is described in the awarding the contract does not comply with the purchasing contract has been disclosed by the Public Works Director through the town manager and to the Board of Selectmen.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Just all those voting in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
The other thing that was placed on the agenda is to looking to expend $4,013 for to acquire a sewer lateral video camera upgrade out of the wastewater system development account. There again, it's a it is a specialized piece of equipment. What the staff is trying to do is it's basically so that the head of the camera can be rotated to look up to the laterals. We need it to inspect because we're trying to track down or chase down a lot of the infiltration that's coming in, and when it just comes in willy-nilly from the laterals, from the services that are come into the main, we presently don't have the ability to check the laterals. We can only look straight up and down the main.
And will you explain why we only got two bids instead of three?
There again, it's a specialized piece of equipment. We already have, and I forget the name of it, I'll say Spectra, and it's something like that. In New England, there are two suppliers of Spectra equipment. So we did get two pieces of paper. I think they differ by a couple $100. It's their cost of doing business. If we got a third one, it'd be from like Kentucky or Mississippi, and we pay more shipping. But there are two vendors, market-wise, in New England, and those are the ones that we got quotes from.
And we have to buy it because it's specific to the camera that we already own.
Yeah, you want the left to match the right and have some connectability.
Do I have a motion?
I make the motion that we accept the to expand $4,013 for the sewer lateral video camera and that it doesn't meet the purchasing policy.
I have a motion. Second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
I'd like to ask Mr. Jacobs something also, because he has given this report about the snow removal along Ocean Boulevard, and I'd like to hear the answer before the presentation is made, because I didn't understand about when you have option one, it says, I would suggest that we have a $500,000 in this account to fund it annually at 100%. Is that for all the snow removal on sidewalks in town?
It could be, if that's the way you designate the funding. Yeah. You,
because I'd like to see it, I'd like to see the town treated as a whole. So I agree with doing it that way, so I just wanted to be able to support your thinking there.
That wasn't an original idea for me. I mean, it was discussed last year about possibly setting up a capital reserve fund for emergencies, be they floods, be they major windstorm, you know, with tree damage, or in the case of 2 winters ago, 120 inches of snow.
Your approach would be as a town wide.
Right, and I don't want the authority to just expend it willy-nilly. I think it's something just like every other capital reserve fund that this group would say.
Yeah, so you're going to be here for the discussion?
Yes.
Yeah, because we'll probably be asking more questions, but I just wanted to understand that before we started. Thank you.
Okay. All set. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next. For people that get up to speak is the Hampton Beach Area Commission with the Hampton Beach Village District.
Just want to say I like all the unanimous votes so far tonight. keep in the right direction.
Oh, you want to make me pipe my tongue?
Does it say?
First thing we're going to speak about is their annual update.
Good evening, and thank you very much for accommodating our rescheduling of this meeting. We would have liked to have come in at the month of April, but due to schedules of both groups, it turned out that this was the closest date that we could get to come in and talk about the annual report and also the sidewalk issue. Let me start by introducing, I have 8 out of 9 commissioners here with me tonight. I've just passed around a list of our commissioners and their appointment dates, showing that, you know, how long that they will be on the commission unless they're reappointed. To my far right, I have Fran McMahon representing the Rockingham Planning Commission. I know most of you, if not all, know these individuals, but for the general public and for the people watching on TV, I would just like to take that minute. We have Chuck Rage representing the Hampton Beach Village District. We have Dean Merrill, our commissioner at large. We have Bill Watson, our executive vice president, or I should say vice chair. John Nyan, Bob Preston representing the Greater Hampton Chamber of Commerce. Bob Ladd representing the Hampton Beach Village District. Mike Hausman representing Dredd was called out to another meeting in another part of the district tonight, so he was not able to come.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, let the record show that this is the Hampton Area Commission, not the Hampton Village District.
Yes, correct. Thank you. You're on the commission.
Yeah, but he's on the commission.
Okay. Well, very good. Thank you.
Yep.
And then we also have our last member, Selectman Griffin, who represents the town of Hampton. I want to just make one comment with regard to our commissioners. As you all know, that this is a volunteer organization. And for the most part, if I was to take a look at the commissioners, except for our commissioner at large, our members have been with us for close to 7, possibly 8 years, dedicated to working on the Beach Commission and all of the efforts of the Beach Commission during all of those periods of time. So I just would like to get that on the record. I also want to clarify one thing about the agenda. It was my mistake. I appreciated the town manager's office changing the agenda tonight. It was my typo where I indicated the second part of the agenda was to talk about the ownership of sidewalks. It was meant to be the maintenance of the sidewalks, so I apologize for that error, and I appreciate the town manager's office so quickly correcting that after it was pointed out to me. My first agenda item is the annual report. Under RSA 216-J:3, Roman numeral number 8, we are obliged to bring a report up to the Board of Selectmen along with state officials once a year on or before November and give them our annual report. That annual report in writing was submitted along with all of the other annual reports for the town of Hampton at the end of 2015, and they're included in your annual book. We have had customarily the last couple of years then gone in front of the selectmen, usually in the March time frame, because at that point we know what selectmen are here, and just to give somewhat of a verbal report on our activities. I just want to take a minute and highlight what I would consider 8 major points of our activities in 2015. And then the first, and I think this was really important because of our coordination requirements under our RSA, is that, as we all know, in the March-April timeframe, we had a lot of snow in 2015. And the Beach Commission was able to coordinate with the assistance and help of the town, especially the Public Works Department, DOT, and DRED, to remove a ton of snow down at the beach. Everybody remembers that one day there's a ton of snow and the next day it's all gone. And that was through the spirit of cooperation between the town and the state. And I will just add that the Beach Commission was directly involved in the coordination and facilitation of that that event. Next is, as we have from many years, supported the completion of the seawall up at North Beach, and Senator Stiles' efforts all throughout the years to have that seawall completed. The Beach Commission continued to advocate and was asked, and we responded very quickly in appreciation of, to help host the ribbon cutting of the completion of the seawall. That was an event that we actually saw, after many years of hard work from the Senator, come to completion. And the Beach Commission, once again, through its advocacy and support of not only in terms of doing letter writing, but also testifying up in Concord in support of her bill. The third, last summer, we knew that we wanted to at least start the conversation with community groups and residents of the beach to talk about the south entranceway coming into Hampton and how we could improve and make some suggestions on some improvements. And we held 3 meetings during the summer with individuals both from the town, which was represented, different departments from the town, the state, DOT, DRED, but also residents of Hampton Beach coming in and just talking about what they would like to see coming over the bridge. And a lot of great ideas came from that. And a lot of great ideas have been now noted and saved. Unfortunately, some of the ideas require funding. Some of those ideas are more long-term than short-term. But I think it was a great effort from the Beach Commission to facilitate that type of discussion to at least get it started. And once again, there was representation from all parties that attended and participated in those conversations. During the summer, early summer, the Hampton Beach Area Commission, along with the support of the town and a letter from the town, went to a public hearing and advocated once again for additional money in the transportation 10-year plan. We had the opportunity for Executive Counsel Chris Nuno to come down to the beach as part of his regional public hearings, and we continued to advocate the need for more money in the transportation 10-year plan. From our advocacy, and once again with the support of the town. It has now been put into the transportation plan, approximately $8 million over and above our $250,000. Into the master plan for Ocean Boulevard reconstruction. That was a very success. Senator Stiles was very active, being the Senate chair of the Transportation Department, Transportation Committee. And I also should suggest that the Department of Transportation was very supportive in our efforts to talk to Executive Counselor and indicate that that project is critical, not only to Hampton, but to the entire state. We continued throughout the year talking about economic development. We understand that Hampton Beach is still growing, both publicly and privately. And we continue to look for different ways of how we could support different economic development projects and initiatives to make that happen. And we will continue that into this year. We continue to partner with the building inspector. There were a number of occasions throughout 2015 where, upon recommendation of Mr. Schultz, developers, homeowners came to us asking us to help them and provide guidance to their architectural design. This was something that the Beach Commission, through the efforts of Tom McGurk a number of years ago, was able to put together a design guideline handbook. So that people understood what we wanted to see in terms of the architectural design of Hampton Beach. So we've had a number of those meetings in 2015, and all, by the way, in my estimation, were successful. Finally, the biggest project that the Beach Commission worked on this past year, and we continue to work on, is the transportation grant. If you recall, back in 2012, we made a first effort. Senator Stiles and Mr. Welch and myself made a visit to Washington, D.C., to the transportation, Federal Highway, and it was an interesting day trip, especially when we found out that the first address that we were going to was the wrong address, and we had to walk 45 minutes to get to the right address because we couldn't flag down a taxi. Anyways, long story short on that one, although we had put in what I thought was a very good supportive application, which one was supported by the state and the governor as the number one priority for the state of New Hampshire, it failed. And the feedback that we got from Federal Highway was that they really couldn't consider our application, primarily because it was not on the New Hampshire 10-year master plan. So we went back to the drawing boards and we said, all right, how do we get on that 10-year master plan? And so that's when we first received that $280,000 grant to get into the master plan. So that was that first step. Then we also noted that maybe we should start small and take a look at transportation within the Hampton Beach Village, Hampton Beach master plan itself. So the Beach Commission made a decision to go and file an application once again with the Federal Highway. This time was for $375,000 to have a study, restudy done of the Hampton Beach master plan and take aspects of that plan and anything referencing transportation that we would take a look at and see what the authors back in 2001 were thinking in terms of what their suggestions and strategies were, and to revisit all of those, but also to take a look at some of the things that we really needed to work on with regard to recommendations, such as Ocean Boulevard and other related areas on Hampton Beach. We were successful in getting that grant, and it was partly due to, once again, the town's support, and partly due to the support that we had received from the state, and specifically the Department of Transportation. We entered into an agreement with the Department of Transportation at the end of 2014, and we kicked off the project in 2015. And some of you, if not all of you, participated in a number of hearings that we have had throughout the year, trying to get feedback from not only residents, but town officials, state officials, Everybody that would have what I would call a stake in Hampton Beach under the eyes of transportation and transportation-related issues. And we have continued to do that. As a matter of fact, next month we will be getting a final draft report from the DOT's contractor, VHB, for us to take a look at and then to go back to our organizations that we represent and talk with them during the summer to see which alternatives that they would prefer and what some of the suggestions that they are making with regard to the master plan we should consider and which ones we should not consider. So that has been a big part of our strategy in 2015, and once again, it will continue to be that strategy in 2016. That, to me, is really the highlights. I know you all have the annual report. For further detail, I might add that a very important part of the commission has been our administrative assistant, Ann Marchand, who I know is watching TV tonight and watching us. Ann has been our secretary for a number of years now, and as part of our RSA, we are supposed to get support for administrative services either from the town or from state parks. And what we did to save money for both organizations, a number of years ago, we raised private funds that we continue to pay for secretarial administrative services for Ann without asking the town or the state to pay for that cost. Saying that, I would like to open for any questions that you might have with regard to the annual update, and then we'll move to the second agenda item.
Regina.
I don't have any questions right now, no.
None right now.
Okay. Phil.
I would defer to our member rep, and then I'll follow, please, sir.
Okay.
Well, I've been on the board probably 5 years on the area commission, and we've worked very hard doing a lot of things that, you know, particularly we worked very hard on getting the new buildings that were put there and working as the liaison between the town and the state. I mean, yeah, the town and the state. And that is one. When the Hampton Area Commission was chartered by the legislature, it was done so that we could have this commission that would work with to facilitate a conversation between the town and the state and make sure that we can report back and, you know, share information so that we can all work together. And I think that's what's important here, working together. We realize things don't always work out perfectly. I know that one thing that that we worked on this year was to get the study continued all the way to Winneconnet Road, because I think that is where the town people generally come from that area, from Winneconnet Road or coming down from High Street. So it's important that that area from Winneconnet Road, it's also where Winneconnet Road is where the Hampton Area Commission is. That's the final ending of, not, I don't mean the Hampton Village District. It ends at Winneconnet Road. So, and the Hampton Village District also has worked very hard also. So it facilitates a conversation between the Village District, the Hampton Area Commission, the state, and the town. So it's worked out good so far. And I think that we're on the right track to getting some things done. Thank you.
Bill?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, Mr. Chairman, good evening. Thank you for your attendance tonight. And there's no finer class of business people or public servants than those that sit here tonight and pursuing business interests in the North Atlantic, very close to the Atlantic Ocean in this day and age, is not an easy task. Mr. Chairman, I'll direct my comments to you. I perused the website and thank you for your annual report. And in doing so, it spurs research into what you folks do. And that's consumed a large part of my day today in discussing the Hampton Beach Area Commission. I will say that on the website, the last minutes that you have posted are from pretty close to 2 years ago. I would request that those get up to speed as we look at Cannon Mountain, as we look at the four other commissions. Their minutes are up to date within several months, and yours are a couple of years old now. So it makes it easier for the governing body and their citizenry to research and have these discussions and assist you in your efforts so we can assist ourselves. But again, it's 2 years out, and I spent a lot of time today wobbling around both the Department of Transportation's website and the State Parks website, and the data is not easily secured. So if we can get that along with the other commissions to that standard, that's great. I'm specifically looking at the Cannon Mountain Advisory Commission, and again, I want to just limit my remarks to the commission. We contribute, by virtue of our operations, just out of our Hampton Meter Fund at the town of Hampton, four times what Cannon Mountain provides for the real estate park transfer. Four times. Just from our meters. Just from our meters. And this is to educate the public on what goes on and the greatness of what goes on at the beach. At their 15 April meeting, the Dred Commissioner, Mr. Rose, attended. And he attends a lot of commission meetings, but he doesn't come here. I would perhaps on behalf of the board, on behalf of townspeople, and certainly if he's making the Cannon Mountain Advisory Commission meetings, that I would like to see him here, because we make a lot of money for his outfit. Phil Bryce attended that meeting. He's not here tonight. I would like to see him on behalf of the town of Hampton, on behalf of your commission. I would respectfully ask that they come to future meetings. Chairman McLeod of the Cannon Mountain Advisory Commission went over their enabling legislation to found the Cannon Mountain Advisory Commission. And of course, yours, as you stated, is the 216J1. It's the Hampton Beach Area Commission. And it was put in effect in June of 2003. It calls for, I believe, 9 members. And there are a lot of people that are Hampton residents on that, and there are people that aren't Hampton residents on that. There are people that are state employees, and it's an interesting document, and you can read that. You've got under 216J3 the powers and duties of the commission. So that is your enabling law, and it mirrors the Cannon Mountain Advisory Commission. It specifically refers to a 2001 document, the Hampton Beach area, and I'm saying this so the people at home watching can understand, because I don't think they get a full understanding of this. This RSA 216J1 specifically refers to the Hampton Beach Area Master Plan, and it's some 200 pages long, and many of us have read it and reread it and read it and read it again. Your changes to that and your updates in the 15 years would be of interest to the public, and as such, if they are readily available, to put on the website, as other commissions do in the state. We're now into the past the 3 to 9 year phase, in phase 3 of your Hampton Beach Area Commission. And I don't see updates to it, and I'll go over briefly what it calls for in this time period. And this is the document that is referred to in law. It's to acquire permitting is needed for public projects. That's on page V5. And it talks about ensure the beach is clean. That is on page V6. And this is specifically talking about implementation. Close off portions of Ocean Boulevard. Reconstruct Ashworth Avenue. Support parking needs. And extend events and attractions to the shoulder in off season. Maintain the 6-foot depth of the channel and mooring field. Install underground electric service along the main beach entrances. And ensure gas capacity needs are met and linked with the development, and gas lines are properly mapped. So that's what the document says, and I think that needs some work, and that's my opinion. I don't speak for the board. And it says here on page V3 that the plan is to be updated every 4 years as a means to ensure recommendations will meet the needs of the program, the goals, the strategies, and the recommendations. So we'll be looking for your updates every 4 years that you've had. On page 424, it talks about the matrix of economic strategies, the long term, 10 to 50 years, and I'm not necessarily a 10 to 50 year planning guy, but economic incentive and economic development programs. This document says keep tabs on existing businesses, marketing programs and special events, identify new housing markets, physical improvements, tie into regional transportation networks. So I think it's I think it needs a little work. I think, in fairness, it's a tired document, and I look forward, me personally, to the upgrades as required by law. We talk about investment in the community, the town, in association with its partnership with the beach, did about $17 million. Is that right, Mr. Welch? Yes. $17 million. And the assessor's office, in terms of private investment, from 2006 to the present date, pushes very close to $100 million. That's private people. Many of whom are here that have invested in their own capital, invested in their own real estate, and invested in the future of Hampton Beach. What has been important and instructive is to realize, as you scour these websites, is the miraculous contribution that the business owners, that your commission, that the people of Hampton and the beach have made to this joint effort. And I've spent hours and hours, and this is an old report. It's difficult to get current data anywhere, and certainly sometimes that goes to the state. I paddleboarded out from Route 1 out to 95 yesterday, came upon the liquor store, and it spurred my thoughts about the great revenue camp that this town is for the state of New Hampshire. And the revenue they grab out of this town is pushing $200 million, rooms and meals, tolls, liquor, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Our operational costs are hundreds of thousands of dollars a year to support that. So it was interesting, and this is from the 2014 financial report, and it's interesting how great a message that your commission can report is it compares and contrasts the Cannon, is it contrasts and compares the Sunapee, and what a great job those that sit with you, Mr. Chairman, your commissioners and business owners that are here today, and stakeholders and people with skin in the game have contributed to the state. It talks on the financial report that there's an all funds approach to the park system, and we just said that Mr. Bryce and Commissioner Rose attend regularly the Cannon Mountain Advisory, but they don't come here, and we do four times what they do, and that doesn't count the $200 million in their revenue camp that they have in Hampton.
How much is that? You say four times. Do you have a dollar figure?
I do. I'll get to that. Okay. I'll get to that. I have specific details from their website. And so they talk about an all-funds approach, but in the middle of winter when we have business owners that don't have the state parking lot plowed, when they don't have the sidewalks plowed, when they don't provide the services to Hampton people, this should be an all-operations approach. And they're funneling money out of that meter and out of that Hampton Beach operation to other parks. And it says the all funds approach is used to recognize the shared nature of costs and to allocate costs to the correct revenues with the various business units. And I would say that the state park system, I would say to Mr. Bryce, I would say to Mr. Rose, that they need to get that in line, because we need our money here to support ourselves before they start sending it up to other revenue camps. The Hampton meters operating, in the most recent data I had, it was 2014, the revenues were $2.1 million. They transferred directly into the state, and I know you know this, $1.6 million. We can build our own seawall without the state ever bonding money, and that's what they do, just out of our meters, just out of our meters. Cannon transferred last year, and they far exceed our debt and what we bond for the seawall by a large sum, and I'll get to that. Cannon did $324,000. $324,000. They get hundreds of thousands of dollars of marketing support, and we blow them away. When I say we, the people in this room that are here tonight. The underlying strength of our self-funding model is that revenues generated from the enterprise parks, which is Hampton, are reinvested for the benefit of the entire state park system. We need to make sure that we're taking care of this one 12 months a year. The remaining, it talks about they've capped the Hampton Capital Improvement Fund at $200,000 per year. So that's all we get. We are simply a sieve for the rest of the park system, for the rest of the state. And that needs to be approached, that needs to be addressed, in my opinion, with state regulators, the commissioners, and the directors down there. And they can start by showing up at these meetings. They talk about the seawall. 50% of the general fund and then 50% of the Hampton Meter Fund goes to that seawall. We can build our own seawalls without the state with just the money that's coming from the meter fund, not even the rest of the state park system in Hampton. The assignment of the debt service of the meter fund will reduce the year-end transfer of the Hampton Meter Fund balance to the park fund in the future. We haven't really seen that. And it hasn't been explained, and we can't address that with the commissioner, and we can't address that with Mr. Bryce. It talks on page 5 of this report that seasonal staff costs in the park system have risen $0.6 million. Now, I know Hampton's increase isn't a big part of that. So they're running a lean operation down there. And if you look at Cannon, it's getting eaten alive, and it runs in the negative. Eaten alive runs in the negative. We're subsidizing that. And if you study this document, as we all should as leaders, and it is the Department of Resources and Economic Development, their fiscal year ending statements, it's pretty bleak, and there's room for improvement, and there's room for improvement in Hampton. There are a myriad and a plethora of parks that make no money, that charge no money, and if you go up there in the wintertime, there's nobody at them, and their parking lots are sanded, and I've been there, and I cross-country ski up there, and they're beautiful, and our park system and our parking lots look like a third world nation. And it's tough to conduct business down there. And it's tough to make money down there when those are the conditions of the state. And again, they have an all parks and an all funds concept. It should be an all operations concept. When you look at Cannon specifically, and we want to compare and contrast because this is a commission and this is a state park. Cannon total revenue was $6.1 million. Hey, we did 2.1, we shoved off 1.6. Cannon shoved off to this parks fund $324,000. These are their numbers. These are their financial statements. We're getting smoked. We're getting totally smoked. And numbers don't lie. And they, at Cannon, when you look at their expenses, they spent $300,000 on marketing for Cannon. So they're not cleaning your parking lots. They're sending all the money to the other state parks, and they're spending $300,000 to have them drive right by you, especially when there's no snow last year. I don't get it. It doesn't make sense, and I think it needs to be addressed. The seawall repair, if you look at the bonding, if you look at the capital expenditures, between 2015 and 2027, the Hampton Beach Capital Improvement Fund, which is already bonded, is a total of $1.5 million. $1.5 million. Cannon, which is losing money, Cannon, which smokes us in terms of keeping money and getting hundreds of thousands of dollars of marketing revenue, Cannon's total bonding is $4.6 million in that same period. So, again, they're getting more marketing, they're losing money, they're keeping more of their money, they're getting more of the visitors, and they're getting more for their infrastructure. There is a, and we'll come to this, and it'll have some closing remarks, but I have studied this, and I think it's valuable, and I think your annual report is valuable. There is at the Department of Resources and Economic Development a guiding principle for leases, and I think it's time we started leasing some of the state property. And Sunapee, of course, leases itself out to Okemo, which is a Vermont corporation, and they just had a big addition out there. And you'll be surprised that I've studied that lease extensively. I'll get to that in a second. And I think there's room for the Area Commission in the town of Hampton to start looking at accepting responsibility for our own operations within our own zip code. But there's guiding principles for the lease. There is Forest Lake. There's Jericho Campground. There's Sunapee Ski Area. The Seacoast Science Center, New England Ski Museum, Franconia Notch Ski Club. There's the Yeckert and Coleman SP. And there are, again, myriad and a plethora of people that are already doing that, including Sunapee, And also of note, Sunapee's retail operations send money over to Cannon Mountain as well. I don't think Hampton Beach is getting any money from Sunapee, are we, Mr. Welch?
Not that we're.
No, I don't think we are either, after a careful review. So again, you know, for the commission, the lease for Sunapee, almost 1,000 acres of an ongoing ski resort, the price that they pay, and that doesn't include the new addition, for 1,000 acres and a ski resort, is $150,000 a year plus 3% of the gross. And they skim a bunch of the gross. So that's one heck of a deal. You give that to Mr. Preston, he could make some money with that. You give that to Mr. Merrill, you give that to Mr. Rage, $150,000 a year, they're leasing a Vermont corporation, Okemo, and they have just renegotiated an expansion. There was an initial term of 20 years. It can renew for two 10-year periods. And then on this latest new lease, I believe it's another 20 years that they can extend the lease. So it's a 50-year lease at $150,000 a year for a mountain. And again, they subsidize Cannon. Commissioner Rose, again, who's not here tonight, he's issued his final decision. It talks about more revenue for the vast expansion that has met some opposition up in Sunapee. It's an additional 10 years. So there was 40 years that were allowed on the first initial lease for $150,000 a year. This final decision for Sunapee is another 10 years. So it's a 50-year lease at $150,000 for a whole mountain. And I think we can do better in Hampton in negotiating in partnering with the state that benefits our state. Dredd has benefited from nearly the $8.5 million in lease payments. These payments have supported extensive capital upgrades at Cannon Mountain. So again, Cannon Mountain is a money loser. Sunapee's making money. Sunapee's leased for nothing. And Cannon Mountain, and this is Commissioner Rose's report, just released. Dredd has supported the extensive capital upgrades at Cannon Mountain. Hampton Beach doesn't get any of that money. As a result, Cannon, which also gets hundreds of thousands of dollars of marketing that we don't get, has increased its skier visits. It's enhanced its financial position. It's provided critical revenue. And we're not getting that. We're getting skunked. And I don't think we like that. We talk about state aid. The town of Newberry, where Sunapee is, in Goshen. Newberry has received since 98 $2.3 million in revenue. We get nothing. We beg. We plead, no one even comes to our meetings. That's how bad it is. They're averaging $130,000 a year. Newberry, they have 2,000 people in that town. Goshen has received $275,000. So there's vast room for improvement. And having said all that and researched and thought about it and commending all of your work, I think that's a start with the state, and this has nothing to do with the sidewalks yet, and that's a whole other issue. I think in line with what you just heard about Cannon, revenue from the meters should go to the Hampton Beach Village District for $200,000 a year. Town of Hampton should receive $200,000 a year, and that's exclusive of any Dredd finance agreement now. And the precedent and the practice is already enforced. There's revenue sharing, and we're getting none, and we're contributing four times as much as Cannon. In accordance with Dredd and the New Hampshire Parks concept of maintenance, all state property should be maintained to standard to include American Disabilities Acts, federal laws to include the sidewalks that we'll talk about later on. That includes plowing state facilities down there and doing a annual maintenance and upkeep and plowing and maintenance that includes sidewalks 12 months per year. It's a shared funding and it's a shared operation, and they're leaving us holding the bag. There should be year-round plowing of the state parks and parking facilities that include the standards of Cannon and many of the North Country ski areas. And finally, we talked about the lease. We know Sunapee's getting leased for $150. I would be in favor, and we can dot the I's and cross the T's, but as a discussion moment, the South Beach State Park, we should lease that for 50 years. Every study from the Hampton Beach Area Commission to the stuff on the Department of Revenue website, Department of Transportation, says that's underutilized. We should lease that for 50 years in accordance with the DRED guiding principle for leases. And we'll give them $150,000 a year and 3% of the gross, just like Sunapee does. Only we're not getting a mountain, we're getting a parking lot in an old building. And Hampton can do one heck of a lot better for itself. It's fair, it's already in play. And those are just some of my comments, Mr. Chairman, and to you, Commissioners, and to you, Mr. Chairman. And I think there's a lot of room for research, and there's a lot of room for growth. And I think this is how we move the ball forward in our dealings with that $5 billion corporation that is the state of New Hampshire. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, may I just respond just to a couple of things? I'm not going to be able to respond to everything because I think a lot of what Selectman Bean has indicated in comparison to Cannon and the state park here is state park. It's not the Beach Commission. But let me just clarify a couple things because I don't want the general public to get misunderstood. A number of years ago, when it was decided that the town was going to assist in taking minutes of our meetings, those meetings have been faithfully posted on the Hampton Town website. Once a month, we post the draft minutes, and then the following month, when the minutes are approved, we post those. So our minutes are posted. We make aware to our state agencies that if you needed to read our minutes, they're on our website, I should say on the town website. So that's one thing. And just a couple of other things. Within the first couple of months of Commissioner Rose being appointed, he did come and he spent a fair amount of time with us at the Beach Commission so that we would be able to share with him what our thoughts are, strategies were with regard to the master plan. And he's been very responsive. Mr. Bryce, in my opinion, goes well beyond having to attend a monthly meeting. He sends Mike Hausman, who is his representative and who also is the supervisor for the Seacoast for state parks. He attends every single meeting. As I said earlier today, he was unfortunate not to be here tonight, which I know he wanted to be. But with Mr. Bryce, I have his work phone number, I have his home number, and I have his cell number, and he has mine. And so we have a working relationship, really, that we don't need to have meetings in order to address issues. The other thing, too, and while we're talking about commissioners, the new commissioner for DOT, within her first week, I think it was within the first couple of days of employment as the new commissioner of DOT, made it a point to come down here and not only meet with the Beach Commission, but met with Jamie as part of a meeting that we had at the police department, and where the commissioner herself came and extended her saying, you know, we're here to help. Let's talk. So I think we are getting the ears of different individuals. As I said, you know, I can't compare Cannon Mountain or Sunapee with the state park here. It's not out of our responsibilities. Mr. Bean, you know, you have a lot of good facts there. I'm sure you've done a lot of research. We're more than happy to, if you want, under our responsibilities to facilitate a meeting with you and State Parks so that you could have that discussion of comparisons between fees and leases and all that stuff. But that's really not what we do. So I just wanted to clarify that, Mr. Chairman.
A couple questions I have. You, Beach Area Commission, who formed that?
It was through the state legislation.
So it wasn't the town, it was the state legislature, and the state legislatures came up with the number of people on it and where they came from?
That's correct. And the only change to that, Mr. Chairman, was back in 2009, through an amendment that Senator Stiles was helpful to put through, was that since there was a resignation of one of the members, and that member was from the Department of Energy, State Department of Energy and Planning, they felt that they did not play a role in the commission. So we were able to get a revision in 2009 from the RSA that would eliminate that position but create a commissioner at large that the other commissioners could appoint. And that commissioner at large has been appointed ever since then. Chief Sawyer, for many years, was our commissioner at large, did a great job. He then, when he became chief, he decided that he'd move on, and that's when we brought in Mr. Dean. That was one change, and then the other change I might add is that we also, during that same amendment, changed the staggering times of the commissioners, because we felt that at it was important that we'd have some consistency within the commission so that not everybody would be up for change all at the same time. So we changed it to a 2 to 3 year staggering period of time. And that's why you see on your list of commissioners the different years that our appointments go to.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to make a couple of statements. And one, there was one time when I was a state rep in on a Hampton issue, and Phil Bryce called me on the weekend. I made a call to him, and he called me on the weekend. He returned the call. So I've seen Phil Bryce a number of times down around the beach and talked to him and has been responsive to what I did. And I think that we have to make sure that we separate what Selectman Bean's talking about between the state and the town and the commission. I think the commission, from what I've seen, has done an excellent job of trying to promote and move that master plan forward and address the issues in the master plan in doing that. And I think that that's very important, that, you know, we have issues with the state, but I think the commission is helping us deal with those issues. And when we talk about Cannon and Sunapee and expansion, we have to go down and look at the west side of the beach down there, and we have to look at the $18 million that was put into the structures down there. And I drove down there today just to take a look, and if you look at the west side of the beach, it's great. The boulevard itself, on the other side, needed a lot of work. And if the state's willing to cooperate with there, I think that's an issue too. But I think there are issues, and there are issues with rooms and meals taxes, which Senator Stiles fights all the time, which I know the commission is going for. But that's the state and the town. That's not the commission and the town. So I just want to make clarify that the town, I think the public, that they're doing a great job. They're working at the master plan. They're working at chipping away at it. And I think we do have response from state people.
I would just like to say that I also have met with Phil Bryce, and if you called Phil Bryce, he'd meet you at any time, Phil, and he'd be glad to talk to you. What the policy of the state is, for having been here for 12 years, and it's very clear what their policy is they won't come here because they've been attacked over and over and over again, not quite as, in a lot worse than what Phil, you know, a lot harder. I'm talking right now. Okay.
No one's attacking anybody.
You can talk to these people at any time. They will, all you have to do is make an appointment. I don't know about Mr. Rose, but I do know about Mr. Clement because I met with him, and that's all you have to do is ask. The reason why they don't want to meet is because they have to go back and discuss it with the governor's council or all these other people before they could make a decision. And a decision can be made when there's, they'll meet with two selectmen, but they won't meet with three. That's been the policy the whole time I've been here. The boards have all accepted it for all 12 years. They weren't happy, but everyone's realized and no one has challenged it. I couldn't agree with Phil more that these issues need to be dealt with, but they don't need to be dealt with in regard to the sidewalks. You mentioned all the money. Well, between 7 Ocean Boulevard and 615 Ocean Boulevard, the taxpayers there pay $4.5 million to the town of Hampton every year. And over the next 8 years, that will amount to $36 million. The Hampton Beach Village District the taxes that are collected there amount to over $12 million each year. And over the next 8 years, they're going to amount to $96 million. And these are full amounts. And I don't want to see these people that live on Ocean Boulevard held in the crossroads. I'm for separating these sidewalks so that the people that are paying, and they're getting taxation without any representation. They're being pushed back over and over again between the town. So this does need to be done. Exactly what Phil's saying. I'm 100% supportive of that. That's what we're talking about here, Rusty.
As long as we're talking about the commission, that's what we're talking
about. I'm talking about what he just said. And I'm responding to what he just said. And I'm all for having a discussion. The sidewalks are another issue that we're going to deal with. But there's, like I said, just on Ocean Boulevard, $4.5 million a year goes, and we're getting nothing.
Just one last rebuttal. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am just talking strictly financial numbers an urgency to and perhaps sit down and discuss those with people. And if that, and I don't think Rick was saying I was attacking anybody, but this is business. This is a $26 million corporation. The state's a $5 billion corporation. And I was quite frankly surprised when I started doing the research on how much less well Hampton is doing than some of the other places. And these are commissions, they are commissioners. And simply to invite someone into your house, Mr. Rose and Mr. Bryce, I think is nice because they make four times what they do in Canon. And nobody's attacking anybody. And we have said that these are some of the best business people in the world. And I've lived around the world. And I've lived around the country. And it's great caliber of people. And it's a discussion. And there's a lot of money out there we're not getting. And it was strictly metrics. It was strictly data. It's provided by the state. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And I would like to respond. I'm not saying that Bill's attacking them, but I did see several selectmen here attack them. And I could name them if that's necessary, but it's happened over and over and over again, and that's why they don't come.
Yes, sir.
And those selectmen aren't here anymore, I don't believe.
They were voted out of office, and there's a lesson to be learned there.
So, bringing it back to the board, do we have any other questions for the commission? Does anybody on the commission like to speak for you?
Not, they're going to be speaking on the sidewalk issue. But if you wanted to add one thing.
I've been village district commissioner for years, and the relationship with the state 12, 15 years ago was different than now. And I got to tell you, if I need to get in touch with Phil, if I need to get in touch with Hausman, I need to get in touch with Mr. Watson. It's like that. And everybody is working together. And I think that if we look to the future, we need to work together and work with each other. And maybe some of these issues that Phil's talking about could be resolved. But we need to get to the table. And I think that's the only way to move forward. And I think Senator Stiles has made it a lot easier for all of us. And I urge this board to meet with these people and make things happen.
I would like the record to reflect that the figures that I just mentioned I got from the tax collector today. And then they're actually on the low side because they're expected to go up.
Any other questions on the Area Commission's annual report?
I have nothing.
Seeing none, we will continue on with the...
Okay.
Sidewalks.
My second agenda item is probably an easier topic than the first. What we're passing around now is the recommendation to the Hampton Board of Selectmen. And what I'd like to do is have some comment on this from the commission and then pass it over to the Board of Selectmen for comments and questions. First of all, for, once again, our RSA 216J, under 216J, :3, Roman numeral 1 and 2, it's the responsibility of the Hampton Beach Area Commission to advise and consult on matters that have an impact on the Hampton Beach Master Plan strategies. Advise and consult. We are not decision makers. In this particular case, you will be the decision makers. You will be deciding on whether or not you will accept our recommendation, but you will be the decision makers. The other thing that I think is very important is that when we look at transportation, when we look at traffic control, when we look at reconstruction of Ocean Boulevard, it's very clear in both the existing conditions of the Hampton Beach Area Commission, where it does talk about the poor condition of Ocean Boulevard, and that is back in 2001. And under the transportation and related recommendations, which is in section number 4, it talks about transportation recommendations and the need to reconstruct Ocean Boulevard. So both of the existing conditions and the recommendations indicate that it's within our responsibilities as a commission to explore and review those areas. And then in exploring those areas to try to find remedies, trying to find strategies that would improve on those conditions. But once again, we can only advise and consult. So before I give my comments, I'd like to introduce some members that have asked to speak in front of the board tonight. And the first one is Mr. Watson, once again represents the Department of Transportation.
So good evening, everyone. My name is Bill Watson. For the record, I am the administrator of the Bureau of Planning and Community Assistance at DOT. I've been a representative of this Beach Commission under Commissioner Campbell, Clement, Commissioner Sheehan now, and the interim commissioners in between those as we found the next leader for our agency. My door is always open. Mr. Bean's been to my office and visited me in Concord. I've been down to talk with the town manager and other officials about sidewalks and other related topics. I grabbed the superintendent on her way out the door to my office that oversees the Safe Routes to School program. So if she's looking for some more money for some of the sidewalks related to Safe Routes to School for the Marston School, she'll be contacting me tomorrow or my staff tomorrow to see what opportunities we have, because there is some leftover money out there. And for many of these topics, it's why I love my job and I love being with this Beach Commission. And not many people in state service can say they love their job, quite honestly. That being said, I have the opportunity to work with many people, and when I need support from others, that support is there, and when the commissioner's office feels that I'm doing an okay job, then they let me do what I feel I do well. So as we go through the evening tonight, in one of those cases where I do need support, we like to bring our directors and our appointed officials out, so I'll just identify them in the back. Dave Rodrigue is our director of operations. Dave oversees maintenance, all highway maintenance for the state DOT. So when we talk about the coordination and the cooperation between the state and the town and DRED for cleaning up the snow that appeared and disappeared quickly a couple of winters ago, it's Dave and his staff that make all that possible, as well as many other maintenance needs throughout the state. As it relates to sidewalks, and I'm going to blend a little bit, and I apologize if you'll bear with me for the master plan or the Beach Commission annual report and sidewalks. Our stake is the same as yours in this conversation about sidewalks. We're not in charge. We can talk about ownership and maintenance if you want to think of things and people being in charge of things, but our interests are the same. So as it relates to this $300,000 grant, these federal funds that are updating the master plan right now, the department offered to step in and help the Beach Commission manage the money because there are so many strings attached to the funds. We didn't want anybody getting into any trouble. And I think the superintendent hinted at that a little bit when she was sitting here earlier talking about Safe Routes to School money. And to Selectman Bean's comments about the required updates of the master plan, that's the exact reason why we have this grant from the Federal Highway Administration, is to do those updates that we should be doing, whether it's according to state law or just good business. So the DOT is helping to manage the project. We're overseeing the funds, make sure they're spent in compliance with federal highways requirements. But in terms of the products, the updates of the master plan, any recommendations that come out of it, any recommendations from sidewalks, it's the Beach Commission that is the owner of that master plan update. So it's all of us sitting here, and you all you up at the table, represented by John and Rick, and all of the other organizations that are represented by the gentleman who's sitting here. And it's important to point that out, that as we talk, this isn't an us versus them conversation. This is all of us that have been working together. John already mentioned that through the 10-year plan process 2 years ago, there was an effort with Councilor Sununu's support to add $250,000 to the 10-year plan to study Ocean Boulevard. That's above and beyond the $300,000 that we have right now today. For the master plan update. And there's going to be money left over from that master plan update that can continue to inform and start the study, the actual design work on Ocean Boulevard. As Senator Stiles mentioned earlier, we have not only about $8 million total dollars now in the 10-year plan for reconstruction, the engineering's moved up into 2019 and 20. So we have a study going on right now that's going to finish in the next year or so. We're going to, which is a high-level master plan update, and we're going to dive right into the engineering of Ocean Boulevard. And in 19 and 20, we're going to be talking about what those ultimate improvements will look like. We're going to have actual design plans created, informed by many of the meetings that we've had over the last year or so, public hearings, public meetings. Many of you have sat in them. The past board has been involved in them as well. To identify what the vision is for the future moving forward. And ultimately, we're going to get to a point, and this is where it may become a little bit more DOT versus the town in some ways, that we have to have a conversation about sidewalks. And that's a conversation that whether it was Chris Clement or whether it's Victoria Sheehan or myself or whomever we're representing, the department is open and ready to have with the town. And compromise is part of the solution. Whether it was Representative Rice's comments earlier that we all walk away a little unhappy in compromise, or we all look at the positive side of that as to what the Seacoast has to gain from all of the parties working together. I think we've all seen what we have to gain with what Dredd has already accomplished with the work on the east side and how that's benefited the beach in general. So I guess, I'll wrap up quickly. We are here. The department is supportive of conversations. We do not maintain sidewalks, and that is a reality of this conversation we have to work with over the next few years. If now is the time that the board is interested and open to having conversation with the agency, you have the commissioner's commitment. You have it from my voice. You have it from the senator's voice earlier. That we're ready to come to the town. We're ready to come and meet with all of you, and work on a solution that is acceptable and workable for all of us.
But to clarify, because I think this is very, very important. Correct me if I'm wrong. That the willingness from both parties to work together, one has to understand that the acceptance of the maintenance of the sidewalk cannot be used as a it's not something that can be put on the table. Yeah.
I think the director can speak for me with a great level more detail, but it is safe for me to say that we do not have the staff or the dollars. Selectman Bean, you're rightfully frustrated at the lack of revenue that the town gets back from the meters and rooms and meals tax, etc. We don't get any of that dollar any either. None of that money comes to the department to maintain anything down here in the beach area. We don't have any additional resources for maintaining sidewalks. We don't have any staff for maintaining sidewalks. The gas tax that's out there, the road toll that's out there, is barely enough for us to fund our operations to keep roads open in the wintertime. So as it relates to sidewalks, It cannot be a conversation for us about the state taking on that responsibility for maintaining a sidewalk.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Rage.
I'll be quick. The commissioners of the Hampton Beach Village District unanimously voted for the Board of Selectmen to support the Hampton Beach Commission. And I've sent a letter in, I'm sure you've all got it, with our motion. I think bringing everybody to the table and coming up with a solution is very doable. And we will help in any way that we can. And I know everybody in this room has been down to the beach from the bridge all the way down to Winnicott Road. We've seen the conditions of the sidewalks. And something has to be done. This isn't a 10-year plan. I don't want it to be in the 20-year plan. I don't want it to be in the 30-year plan. I've been down on the beach since 1981, and every year it gets worse. And I see people tripping. I see flooding. I see that there's so many layers on Ocean Boulevard. I think we're at 9 now. I'm not sure. That there isn't a sidewalk. That people walk into the street, and are we going to wait till there's more accidents? And are we going to wait till there isn't a way for people to load and unload, getting into their businesses, where trucks are going to be hitting pedestrians because there isn't a sidewalk. People just walk everywhere. And if we can get a proper sidewalk where it's not 3 feet wide, where we have an area where people can walk. I was down the island section. The island section seems to get forgotten a lot of times. And there was one sidewalk there that I don't think it was 30 inches. And I wish I was a little smaller. I could fit on a 30-inch sidewalk, but I can't. We definitely need to work on this for the town, for the village district, and for our tourists. Thank you.
Mr. Morrow, would you like to add? I know that you were at a wedding at our last meeting, so congratulations, by the way.
Well, thank you. For the record, I'm Dean Merrill. I'm the commissioner-at-large, I guess larger in a few pounds from the wedding, which was a great time, but my wallet's a lot lighter. I've been on this commission, I guess the young person for 3 years, but I've got to know what this group of people do, and also my ear is to, you know, residents down at the beach, along with the town, and then customers and so forth. I think there's no debate that this, you know, the sidewalks need to be fixed, repaired and maintained and those type of things. And I was looking down at some things like maybe Phil was looking at, and maybe I'll bring up my grandfather because he was in the state legislature. And this is probably around the same time, 1933, that he was probably up there and helped draft this agreement. I will say that I know Mr. Rice had mentioned the Model Ts and whatever. There was a Model T down the beach last week. I was driving it. But my grandfather would always look forward thinking. Never talk about the past. Never talked about his what he grew up with. But it was always forward thinking. And I think that's what this commission has done as this group. And, you know, just to bring this forward to, I appreciate the time tonight because we really think it's an important issue, and let's see if we can get it done.
Mr. Chairman, would you let the record show that Mr. Merrill, while he is the commissioner at large and he lives in Exeter, he has and his family lived in Hampton Falls, but they've been business people that have operated here in Hampton forever. And so he's a very active business person here in Hampton.
We also own property up on High Street, too, with offices.
Good. So then you are a taxpayer.
Next is, and I just want to just add one verbal comment with regard to Mr. Hausman and Mr. Bryce, who I was with last week, both of them. And in conversation with both, shared with me that I could, with their permission, share with the Board of Selectmen tonight that they will continue to support the efforts of winter snow removal on the east side of Ocean Boulevard as long as the budgets continue on. But they are very willing to continue to be partners with the town and take their responsibility with regard to snow removal on the east side of Ocean Boulevard. We now have Mr. Preston representing the Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you, John. In order to not to be redundant, I submitted many of my comments to you already for you to have a minute to look over. The reason being is I'm the quiet one on the board and they don't give me a chance to talk very much. And after you heard Mr. Lawson, you know he's the eloquent one. So that he's hard to follow. A couple of you people have served in Concord. You know what that's like to bring forth legislation up there. It's really an uphill battle. You know, and yet, when I look at the efforts of Senator Stiles, she's incredible. You know, for her to bring this forward, being the chairman of the Transportation Committee, you know, that's a great accomplishment in itself. For her to bring that kind of money to Hampton is wonderful. You know, we work with Bill Watson and Mike Hausman all year long for several years. I don't think it's appropriate to hear, you know, that we fight with the state, because I can tell you there's a lot of cooperation with what we do. When you look at a plan like this, you got to say to yourself, oh, well, you know, what if you vote it down? I'm going to say, well, when is the next opportunity going to come along? The state doesn't come in and say, we're going to spend $6 or $8 million, you know, in your town. And they particularly don't want to do it when you want to beat them up. Now, I heard earlier that we're a third world nation. Well, I got to tell you today, this week I voted for Hampton Beach as one of the best boardwalks in the country. And we were number 7 the last I read. So I don't think that it's fair to say that they don't do anything for us. You look at what's happening down that beach, it's incredible. I do want to go over a couple of the comments that I said to you just for the public. You know, years ago, the town voted to spend a lot of money. And when they did that for the infrastructure, that's when things began to change. We didn't know it, but that's when they started. All that money, most of it went underground, but a lot of it went into sidewalks. So when you go down Ashworth Avenue today, those sidewalks look pretty nice. Sometime after that, again, Senator Stiles, John, a lot of people in this room said, we're going to lobby to get a new seashell. And many of us said, with the economy that we had at the time, we're never going to get $14 million in town. And yet they did it. And that new seashell has become the jewel of the state park system. At that point, within a couple of years, the seeds of growth of Hampton Beach became millions of dollars of private money has started to come in to the beach, you know, with all the new condos. But it's not just condos. In my end, I look at all those houses that have been totally renovated. And those are just as important as the big buildings, because they help keep the character of our town, which we all want, I think. So we're here to ask you that we want to continue with the transformation of Hampton Beach. And it is a transformation. I mean, it's amazing when I hear from my guests, you know, how much better it looks, and they don't remember anything like that. People have not been here for 5 years have no clue on how it looks. Now, you, the board, have an opportunity to get an additional $6 million, but it's probably more, and it could be when we're all done, $16 million to redo the boulevard. I think this is great for Hampton. I think it's great for our town's tax base. The assessments are all going to go up. The things that are happening down there are phenomenal. In order to get this big investment, the cost to us is we're going to maintain the sidewalk. Who's maintaining the sidewalks? I walked that boulevard. Nobody's maintaining those sidewalks. They're terrible. I don't know what they're going to look like in 8 years. But this is the start to do something really, really good. And I hope that you can vote with us. Thank you.
And finally, Mr. Ladd.
I certainly don't want to repeat everything that's been said, but I agree with everything that's been said. It seems to me the state and the town in an irreversible marriage. We've got to figure out some way for it to work for both sides. And my experience for many years in the court system was, if you don't talk, you can't solve anything. The only way you fail is when you fail to try. And what I heard from Senator Stiles tonight was the state is already offering the olive branch of taking the snow. If you take it from the sidewalk and put it on Ocean Boulevard, they'll take it away. That, to me, from a mediating point of view, is a significant moment in time. Don't underestimate that. The state is saying, we want to talk. I don't think there should be any doubt that we should talk. What the result of that conversation might be will be determined at some future date. The only mistake tonight that could be made would be to refuse to talk. That would end the conversation, would end the opportunity, and we'll all be dead before the next opportunity presents itself. And this has nothing to do with that, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to make one comment at the end of the meeting. I failed to identify the volunteer coordinator for the sandcastles. And if I don't do that, I may end up under the sand rather.
Okay. I just have some quick comments and then pass it back to you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, people have talked about this 1933 agreement. Well, I guess I would agree with Dean's grandfather's comments that you got to look forward before you look back. And yeah, there might have been an agreement back in 1933, but there's so much been happening and so much has been done since 1933 down at Hampton Beach. I'm not sure how strong that agreement is in today's world. There's been a lot of discussion about how back in 2012, there was a Warren Article 31, that 65% of the residents voted that article down, saying that they did not want the town to enter into an MOU with the Department of Transportation for the maintenance of the sidewalks. Along with that, there was discussions that were brought up about the cost. Cost anywhere from $500,000 to most recently at a planning board meeting where it was $1 million for the town to take over that cost. Well, I believe most recently some of that financial amount has been reduced, both from a liability and from a maintenance cost. So I don't think it's $500,000. But more importantly, that Warren article that people voted down is not what we're recommending tonight. That Warren article basically said, town of Hampton residents, do you want the town of Hampton to take over the responsibilities of the sidewalks 2012? The conditions that the sidewalks are in today. What we're proposing, something totally different. What we're proposing is that the town of Hampton take over the responsibility, the maintenance of the sidewalks, when and only if there are new sidewalks constructed and ADA compliant. Exposure to ADA. I feel as strong as all of you in terms of that is a liability. But right now, the town of Hampton has the responsibility of 29 miles of sidewalk. What we're suggesting is add 2 more miles to that, because that's the distance that we're talking about in terms of the maintaining of the sidewalks that we're proposing. 2 more miles. And those 2 more miles would become ADA compliant before taking over the responsibility. I was quoted recently, and it might have disturbed some of you, about the word compromise, and how I said that, you know, we need to compromise on this issue. And I can assure you, as a representative of the town, appointed by the selectmen, but representing the town of Hampton, that I, as one commissioner, have had a lot of discussions with the state. Mr. Watson will attest that I have been talking to him for close to 2 years now with what if that, what if this. So as a commissioner, I took my job serious to look at both sides of the issue. And I can assure you that if there was a way that I could have talked the Department of Transportation into making an exception in this particular case, I would have tried, and I did. But if you put that aside for a minute, that compromise, well, okay, if they're saying, no, we can't take the sidewalk maintenance, DOT can't take it, but what can we offer the town of Hampton in lieu of? Let me just name a couple of them. First of all, DOT has been supportive from day one when we started talking about the reconstruction of Ocean Boulevard, from day one. The town of Hampton and DOT and the Beach Commission were hand in hand in hand in every effort in looking at funds to reconstruct Ocean Boulevard. So they have been our partner from day one. The grant that they're administering for us right now is all free of charge. It's not costing the grant money. It's not costing the beach commission or anybody. Their administration of this grant is all free of charge. So there's no cost. And as you already heard, both from the senator and from Bill, if we can get past this maintenance agreement, the commissioner, Bill's office, the Beach Commission, everybody will work hard to make sure that compromises of how we can help, whether or not it's pushing the snow on the road and having DOT take the snow away, whatever that case might be. So, you know, when you look at compromise, to me, those are compromises. So in closing, and I'm doing this for the public and for the people in the audience, you all have a written copy of our recommendation. After careful review and consideration and wanting to continue the transformation of Hampton Beach, the Hampton Beach Area Commission is recommending to the Hampton Board of Selectmen that once the Ocean Boulevard construction project has been funded without any cash match requirement from the town, and the work has been completed, which would include a brand new road, all new sidewalks, and drainage. And drainage, we all know, is an issue, not only with the state, but with the town itself. So, roadway, sidewalks, and drainage. Only then would then the town be responsible to take over the responsibilities of the maintenance of the sidewalks on the west side of Ocean Boulevard from the intersection of Ashworth and Ocean Boulevard on the south end up to the intersection of Ocean Boulevard and Winnicott Road on the north end. So in closing, we can only advise, we can only recommend.
Mr. Chairman,
it's your decision.
I would like to make that motion that he just...
Before I hear any motions, I'm going to allow this board to speak first.
Okay,
get
then
questions.
I just want to set... I want to let the... if that's the way it is, because that's not the way we've been conducting business here, but if it's going to be that way, it will be that way every time from now on.
Then make, I would like to make a motion. Make your motion. Okay. We'll have a second, and then we'll have conversation.
Because that's the way we
do it. But we all will have conversation over that.
Yeah, of course we will.
You're right.
That's the way we usually do it. I didn't want to see it be done differently tonight. After careful review and consideration and wanting to continue the transformation of Hampton Beach, the Hampton Beach Area Commission is recommending to the Hampton Board of Selectmen that once the Ocean Boulevard reconstruction project has been funded without any cash match requirement from the town of Hampton, and the work has been completed, new roadway, new sidewalks, and new drainage, that the town take over the responsibility of maintenance of the sidewalks on the west side of Ocean Boulevard from the intersection of Ashworth, Ocean Boulevard, South End, up to the corner of Ocean Boulevard and Winneconnet Road, North End.
I'll second Rick's motion.
Thank you. And as
we're gonna representative, open this up, we're going to open this up for discussion.
And I would like to start.
Go right ahead.
I would just like to make it very clear that nothing is going to be spent for 8 years. There won't be this road. It could be finished faster, but it's highly unlikely, unless some sort of influx comes from the federal government after the election, and that is possible. But I'd say it certainly isn't going to be any more than 5 or 6 years. And from what we talked about at the meeting the other night, it looks like 8 years. The people that live, like when I mentioned about the $12 million that the Hampton Beach precinct pays, that also includes the $4.5 million that the residents of Ocean Boulevard pay from 7 Ocean Boulevard to 615, which brings us down to Winneconnet Road. These same residents paid $421,000, but they didn't pay at all. The whole town paid $421,000 to have the excess snow removed from the beach area. Mr. Welch, does that include the snow that was uptown, like on those roads?
Yes, it does.
So it also includes the snow that was removed. What's the name of that road where we had the big problem with?
Lamson was the biggest
one. Lamson Lane. It was an emergency. So this was in an emergency time. It was $421,000. These residents that write out a check for $4.5 million or more, they gladly contributed to that. They've gladly contributed to all the equipment that has been bought through the years, every plow truck that's plowed for the roads, because the roads at the beach are going to continue to be plowed by the state. Those residents, really, their roads in front of their house are being done by the state, but they still pay to buy new plows. They've bought 3 sidewalk plows, which I believe go for between, is it $250 and $375, Mr. Welch?
The current ones that we have now run about $200,000.
$200,000, okay, I'm off there. I think John said there was 29 miles of sidewalk. I think Chris Jacobs told me today that is 22 miles of sidewalks, Chris?
I'll look at my figures.
He said 22 earlier, so I'm not really sure. I want to make sure we have the right figures here. But these citizens from 7 Ocean Boulevard to 615, it's only 2.5 miles, but yet they pay for 22 miles of sidewalks being plowed as soon as they can uptown. And, you know, they have no other choice but to contribute. They also paid part of that $17 million that was voted by the taxpayers of Hampton to do the infrastructure improvement. They also put up with all of the hell that it was as they did it, but everybody does it because they know it's for the greater good. They all want to work together. We want to work together. When they pay their $4.5 million, they're not thinking about the money that the state gets. That's a whole separate issue, just like Phil said, a whole separate issue. They pay their money, and they're expecting their sidewalks to be taken care of. At least up in the last couple of years, they couldn't even get permission because there was such a backlog between the state and the town to even get permission. Mr. Welch had to work overtime to get the permission. And in fact, the new businesses that go there, they generally pay to have the sidewalks done in front of their place, and people like Chuck have done his own sidewalks on his own. And many people do. But we couldn't even get permission because it was a problem. So I'm totally against, I think these sidewalks need to be removed so that the people that are being taxed get some representation. They deserve to have a say in this, and they're getting no say. They're caught in the middle. The ADA accessible, like I talked to Mr. Welch today, and he says, well, you know, we might have to, there is no problem with insurance if someone falls or whatever, because that's covered under the town's master plan, master policy. And we know that that's not going to go up because we've had that information. Now, there might be...
Pardon me.
Phil, I don't appreciate what you're doing, Phil.
Okay.
I'm
listening to you.
Like
can,
that,
I'm
you
not.
Do it to
I'm
Mary
not
Louise,
left.
But please don't.
I heard
do
that
it
before.
Me.
I'm just go
okay,
ahead. Continue.
But you're going to hear it again
okay,
too.
I know I am.
Okay. So, you know, now I understand why Mary Louise was so unsettled after you did it.
Can we get back on this track, please?
Okay. Well, it's hard.
Well,
when you
then.
Have people laughing that are sitting right next to you.
Can we get back on track, please?
Yes. So I hope.
Thank you.
That was not for me.
It was meant for.
Okay, thanks,
who it was
Rusty.
Meant for.
You know, I, we, these ADA accessible has, we should embrace the fact that we're going to be able to do that. Now, Mr. Welch says that something might go wrong, there'll be some damage. Well, of course, we'll fix it up. I will have to tell you, the state hasn't done anything for the last 40 years on the sidewalks. I've lived on Ocean Boulevard for 50 years. And when I was a kid, they were beautiful, but they're not beautiful now. I also feel that the school has some responsibility to here for the students that live in Hampton. They need to have some place to stand, the people that are on Ocean Boulevard. The state, the town of Hampton at one point didn't do anything for the school kids in Hampton, but after a lot of discussion was made with people that lived down there on Ashworth Avenue, Mr. Welch worked to make it happen, and they now do certain areas of Ashworth Avenue. There should be something like that done on Ocean Boulevard too. And, you know, I can't imagine why anyone would want to have certain areas that are never used to have to plow them, but, you know, we'll see. Also, the sidewalks is only a small part because the roads and the drains also, we're looking to have those done as soon as possible. Because once they do put new drains in, all of a sudden, the two drains that the town has that come down off Boar's Head that are their drains pretty much do nothing now. But the town could tie into these drains and make the drains work so that the water that cascades like a fountain off of Boar's Head could be dealt with. That's the town's responsibility. And, you know, I would like the residents of Ocean Boulevard to be respected. Like recently, when $167,000 was spent on Toll Farm Road, that without little discussion at this board, it just was mentioned, and we voted to do it. They resurfaced it. It's where Rusty lives. He, you know.
Excuse me, sir.
Excuse me.
First of all, Toll Farm Road is a town road, not a state road. So keep your facts straight.
Okay.
Thank you.
$167,000. We're only asking for $100,000. I bet you Toll Farm Road doesn't bring in the $4.5 million that Ocean Boulevard does. And I say we should be treated like the residents of Toll Farm Road. Thank you. And also, I would like to talk about we are going to need more employees probably in the future at DPW for a variety of reasons. And that's a discussion we need to have here.
Are you finished?
Yes.
Thank you.
I'm not finished. I'll be back.
Mr. Bean.
Pardon me for smiling and having some jocularity. Mr. Chairman, could I just hear from the town manager on his interpretation and of this that was put forth tonight. It's the first time I've seen it.
Mr. Chairman, can we go to the rest of the board first?
Can we do that first?
Whatever your pleasure is.
I would rather have the board speak first.
Okay. And then you ask me a question?
And then I'll ask
you. And you asked if I wanted to go next. Okay. And again, sorry, I'm having a good time. This has been an interesting Warren article. Again, it's totally separate from the analysis of your annual report. And you struggle with it, and you look at it, and you listen, and you communicate. And that's what happens when people actually come to meetings, and you understand what's going on, not when they speak to certain people on the phone, not when they speak to certain committee members, but when they actually come up and you have a dialogue. And sometimes people smile, sometimes people get a little stern, but it's communications and it's business. And Mr. Preston owns a business, Mr. Rage owns a business, and there's a bunch of business owners here. And the struggle with this, for me, was Article 31 in 2012. I was at that meeting. And I want to be very careful about what I say, because it's the voters' will, and there was a vote. And as I look at this, and I don't want to walk away from standing up to a vote, because you're a selectman and the motion's been made tonight. And I wouldn't have made the motion tonight. I'd like some more research, and maybe I can get some information tonight from Mr. Welch. But it says that a memorandum of understanding, and I would like to tighten up the motion if we're going to go forward with it, in order that I vote with
motion's
it.
Motion's been made and seconded, any motion will have to be amended.
I understand parliamentary procedure, and I thank you. But it does not say, when the voters voted, it was to maintain, repair, construct, and reconstruct the sidewalks. Now, if it said to maintain or repair or construct, then that would be a clear prohibition for supporting what the Hampton Beach Area Commission wants tonight. But as I read this, and I've struggled to interpret this, and that's why information and conversation is good, the way I am reading it, it's the agreement it was voted against to maintain collectively, to maintain, repair, construct, and reconstruct. And as I read this, that's not what the commission is asking for tonight. They are asking simply to maintain. And there's a big difference. And the voters voted against maintaining and repairing and constructing and reconstructing. And this, which Mr. Griffin, if I can smile without him yelling at me, is a different ball of wax to me tonight than Article 31. And I'm leaning down that road as we go. And then my questions would be, because I don't have any information on exactly what the construction project looks like, but the sidewalks are ADA compliant. What specifications are they made? And we've got Mr. Watson here. That these mirror the Route 1 sidewalks, as Mr. Nyan has asked Public Works, what has been the maintenance outlay on those in the last 15 years or 10 years. And so with the spirit of your intent, I'm moving very close to, and I just wanted to hear some more information, Mr. Chairman, about exactly what that sidewalk looks like, how ADA compliant is it, and what's it going to be, and again, drilling down from what point it goes to what point. So if I hear a little bit more information of that, along with the drainage, that will satisfy my information request tonight, sir.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Well, Judy? I found out from Nancy tonight that one of my concerns was where to, you know, not just getting rid of the snow, but where it would go. Because I know not everyone is around the beach in the wintertime, but 2 years ago there was snow everywhere. So, you know, your department being willing to push that into the street, that's great. That's, you know, I think that would make it more workable for us to actually possibly be able to get to those sidewalks. I'd like to maybe get some more information from Chris at Public Works and see how he feels about it. And, you know, communication, like tonight we're all here together, it's great. Some people aren't here, but it seems that, you know, if I maybe sit down with John Nyan, sit down with Nancy, maybe get the information I need. Believe me, I don't live down there, but I've enjoyed it down there for a long, long time. And I know that work needs to get done. But at the same time, DOT is saying that they don't have the manpower to maintain sidewalks. Well, right now, we don't really either. So we really need to sit additional sidewalks, never mind the ones that we already have, 22, 27, whatever it is, miles of sidewalk. So I think the important thing that we do is get together, get the information. You know, we made a motion. I'm not, like I said, this is the first time that we're actually getting information, but it seems like everyone's willing to work together. And I think that is definitely something that needs to be done. I know the business owners and the residents suffer down there with drainage issues. And, you know, the other side of the beach does look great. And I think that I'm glad all you guys came tonight. You answered a lot of questions I had. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll be less verbose than anybody else. I think Rick made a good point. Fairness. The people out there pay taxes. ADA, you got to embrace ADA. There's no way you can get around it. And you got to accept the responsibility of ADA if you accept it. It's got to be ADA 100%, doesn't it? There's no issue of how it's going to be ADA. It has to be ADA. I know I went down there once last winter with one of my family members who's in a wheelchair, and we were going down to the beach, and the state had plowed the east side, but they hadn't plowed the end of the ramp. That was pretty dumb. but his brother carried him. He got on a big piggyback, so it's no big deal. But, you know, the issue of people taking care of their own sidewalk, the state constitution says you can't do that. That's dumb that they even put anything like that in the state constitution, but they did. But, we've heard people talk. Take a vote.
Okay.
That's my point.
First of all, we've heard a lot of information here. We heard a lot of information from Mrs. Stiles, Senator Stiles, when she started. And so we don't make the mistakes of the past. We still have to look at the past. And we've had a lot of mistakes in those pasts. A lot of things have been said by the state that they won't do this and they won't do that. And it's off the table. We're not going to talk about it. We heard from Senator Stiles tonight. She's willing to bring us together to talk about that. I think that's very important. And much to my friend to the left here, I grew up on Hampton Beach. I spent 45 years of my life living on Hampton Beach. Hampton Beach is where my home always was, and it's where my heart always is. Those roads down there are terrible. The sidewalks down there are terrible. We need to do something. But before we can do something, I feel we need to have a discussion with DOT, with DRED, and I'm hoping that Senator Stiles, I wish she was still here because I wanted to mention this. I hope she could bring us together. I think a vote today, we need some more information. I think it's a little premature, but we have somebody that made a motion and it was seconded. I would be willing to entertain a tabling motion for a couple of weeks. So is that going to hurt our discussion?
There's an old saying, and I think we should follow it, and everybody knows what it is. Something to get off
begins
the pot.
Begins with S, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I agree.
It's time. I mean, we've got the information.
I'm sorry, but I don't think we have it.
Well, I would like to talk again.
I asked for information, and I'm here to talk until the cows come home or until 6 in the morning because this is the town's business. And I think ADA is very important. It's worth spending the time on talking about.
It has to be 100% ADA. There's no question on it.
The state owns it.
It has to be.
Well, it's not now. The state owns it.
When they construct it.
Does that have to do with the fact that it's federal funding, Mr. Watson?
Hold on. That's a good question to answer. Go ahead.
No, it has nothing to do with federal funds. Publicly accessible sidewalks have to be ADA compliant statewide, whether they're owned by the town, the state, or anyone else.
So I've had my piece. Every member of this board has had their piece. I will send it back to Mr. Bean. He asked a question for the town manager, and I think we have the right to do so.
I do want to hear from Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, gentlemen, this is all pretty old stuff. I was looking through the file this morning, and this goes back to the state's reconstruction of Ocean Boulevard in 1959, when those sidewalks were rebuilt. in the early 1990s when the state spent $250,000 on trying to fix things up. And as Bill will tell you, $250,000 is just about enough to scratch the top of this table today. It's not going to do very much. Just to give you the right figures, the town currently has 12.97 miles of sidewalk that we clear. It's another 6.64 miles of sidewalk that we do not clear.
And comes to 22?
Comes to 22. Yeah. Round figures, 22. If we reach an agreement with the state, which is not a bad idea. I think Bill and I tried to do this at one point a number of years ago, and that just didn't work out. We would be adding 2.51 miles, which would be the sidewalks on the west side of Ocean Boulevard, according to their figures. The east side has 4.09, which DRED takes care of. That's part of their responsibilities. And there are other additional sidewalks in town, but they're very small. Nothing that we actually get to maintain or the state gets to maintain. I listened to Senator Stiles when she was here, and she had a darn good suggestion, and that was that the people who live along Ocean Boulevard should help clear. Unfortunately, our state Supreme Court declared that to be unconstitutional about 60 or 70 years ago. So that's out of the picture, even though the town has accepted that statute, and it's currently still in the books. It goes back to a law in the 1890s that the legislature passed and has subsequently been declared unconstitutional. So without amending the Constitution, we're not going to get anywhere with that. So let's move on from that particular item. This is a completely different proposition than what was proposed before. And Bill and I both worked on what was proposed before. The only reason that was stopped was because of a personal telephone call I received from the commissioner at the time, who is no longer the commissioner, who said that cooperation between the town and the state on this issue was dead on sidewalks. We're not talking about it. I said, that's fine. That's okay. That's your privilege. And basically it stopped the talk, although that wasn't the intention. I know Bill was ready to sit down and do an MOU, and so was I. I think what you see here is something that's going to have to go through governor and council, and it's going to have to be a formal proposal that will live with time, because it's got to be a breathing document. This can't be something that's stagnant and dead if you're going to do something of this nature. There needs to be close cooperation between DRED, DOT, and the town to do something of this nature. And it can be done, but this is completely different than what was proposed before. So I think this is worth looking at. I think this is something that we should look at. I think it's something that we should spend some time on. How the board decides they want to do that is their decision, not mine. But I would suggest that we have something rather than an MOU, but actually a contractual agreement between the state and the town to carry out the responsibilities that would be enamored in such a wonderful document, if we can get the bloody thing done, and I hope we can. It would save the town a lot of money, it'll save the state a lot of money, and it will save the people a lot of money. And I think that's where we're all trying to go. That's where we're trying to go before with this. But an MOU won't cut it this time. I think it's got to be an actual governor and council document, so that when we both want to make a change, we go to them and they okay it, and there's a third party that looks at it. So I could go into a lot of detail on our past discussions. I can go into a lot of detail on things that I've learned from going through the file, but I think it would just add a lot of conversation that's not necessary at this point. You need to take a few minutes and not knee-jerk react to the first blush you see. I think you need to explore this, and there is very specific wording here, and it has very specific meanings. And having spent 30 years in public works, I can tell you that somebody handed this to me as a public works director, the first thing I'd say is I want my legal counsel to look at it, because I want to know exactly what it says. And no fooling around about it. We all need to go in the same direction. And that direction should be to do something that's constructive for everybody. So thank you.
Mr. Chairman,
Hold on first. Mr. Bean had asked a question, so I want to make sure his questions were answered.
Right, Dave's question.
So you're saying there needs to be a legal check? Is that your advice on this?
These are words. Mm-hmm. They have specific meanings when put together in this particular form. And I think we all should know from the standpoint, from a legal standpoint, what those words mean when constructed in this particular format. So we're all operating from the same base. So there's no question about what we're doing and why we're doing it. It's no good to get down the road and find out that this means something besides what we think it means.
And this is still a state piece of property that the town of Hampton will be maintaining, is that correct?
From this, yes.
Is that correct? And so there would need to be...
It's got to be an agreement.
And... Got it. And we don't have one now.
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead, Mr. Yeah.
I think to both of your comments, it's assumed right now, Selectman Bean, to the ultimate reconstruction of Ocean Boulevard, if there wants to be a conversation about ownership and transfer of ownership from the state to the town of any portion of the road or the sidewalks, that's a conversation that can be had. I'm not saying we should, I'm not saying we have to, but that's part of the project development process. That's a requirement for us to at least look into those things. So that's not something any of us can answer tonight, what that looks like. That has to happen through the design process. To the wording of the motion or the recommendation that's been placed in front of you, it now forms a motion. I know that's the recommendation from the Beach Commission. If in your review with the town attorney or amongst yourselves, there needs to be some modification to that wording so that when conversation of an agreement moves forward and that negotiating and compromising happens with the department, so that we put something in front of GNC ultimately, if that's our collective goal, then don't be wedded to the wording in here. We'd be willing to compromise and have that communication that so that we walk away with a common understanding and a comfortable understanding. We just want the conversation to happen.
Well, I think we all do.
And again, I feel that the $96 million that the beach is going to contribute or the $12 million that's going to be contributed from Ocean Boulevard, over $12 million, is reason. I don't want the sidewalks to get caught up in this discussion. This discussion that needs to happen, needs to happen. But the taxpayers that live in Hampton need to be served now. And it's unfortunate that this is only one small step. It's still going to take 8 years, but why would we delay it? And I'm anxious to see how the vote's going to go.
I'd like to call the vote.
Okay, we have a calling of the vote. I think...
I would like to amend the motion. And I'm in favor of the spirit of this. I'm in favor of the spirit of this.
I think my motion's motion is a priority, isn't it?
It is a priority motion.
I'm going to follow the parliamentary procedure.
Would you yield, my sailor friend?
If we'll have a motion. It's been seconded. It's been asked to move. If that motion fails, then we can come up with another motion. Doesn't mean that it failed. Doesn't mean that it's over. Just means that we're going forward. Somebody could come up with another motion. Somebody could come up with something else. So we've had a call of a vote. And so I think we have to do that. And so all those in favor of the motion, raise their hands. All those opposed, 3-2, it passes. So.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah. I just want the record to reflect that Phil and I have been friends for about 50 years.
I don't want that on the record.
Mr. Chairman, may I just give that phone?
Sure, go right ahead.
Anyone who'd like to volunteer for the Sea Castle event can call Jim at 603-327-7154 to make the contact. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let me find my...
Wait until everybody clears so we
can...
Make sure my nasty note doesn't get lost.
Okay, seeing that, now we have the... Well, we only got two out of three gone, so, but... We have a town manager's report.
Oh, we still have a quorum, Mr.
We
Chairman.
Have still have a quorum, that's fine.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the USS Hampton has arrived at Portsmouth Navy Base on Wednesday morning for a 20-month-plus stay for essential work and refitting. We should be contacted soon by staff at the Navy Base to put our committee in good order to help those young folks who are over there. It's that time to dog license again. Will you see the town clerk for renewal of your dog's license before the increased fees take effect on June 1st? Memorial Day exercises will take place on Monday, May 30th at the Hampton Beach Marine Memorial starting at 8 a.m. with a parade stepping off at 11:30 a.m. from the fire station parking lot on Winneconnet Road, proceeding down Winneconnet to Route 1, up Route 1 to High Street, and then to the High Street Cemetery for exercises. There will be an outing at the Hampton Academy starting at 12:30, lasting until 2 p.m., where food can be purchased. The Hampton Victory Garden has expressed its appreciation of the Public Works Department for their help in enlarging the Victory Garden so they can now have 50 garden plots available for Hampton residents. They gave a special praise to Toby Spainhauer, who assisted them throughout the two-year process of enlarging the garden area. A couple of other things, Mr. Chairman, as we got through this, and they incidentally sent some wonderful photographs to that garden area that was done. We have the 2016 Household Hazardous Waste Collection Day, which is Saturday, June 4th. The board will not meet again before that time. It's Saturday, June 4th, 2016 at the Public Works Facility on Haddad's Way from 8 a.m. to 12 noon. And if you go online, there is an extensive list of things that you should know that you can bring, and there are some things that you may bring that may be charged for. There's also a list of things that cannot be brought. House Bill 1198, which we've all been very interested in, has gone to the House of Representatives after the Senate's amendment and was concurred in by a voice vote, and therefore is on its way to the governor's office for consideration and perhaps signature. We have staff looking at the recent announcement by the federal government and the signing by the president of the change in the Department of Labor's overtime rules, which will take effect shortly, the July 1, I believe it is. We're looking at that now, and I suspect that we'll be back to the board with a report on that because it's going to affect us. I also have a notice here from Unitil, and this should affect everybody that lives on a Unitil high tension line, particularly the high tension line that runs down and ends up at the beach at their substation. They're going to be spraying herbicides along the entire route of the power line, and they're going to be starting shortly after June 18th. They're going to leave notices at everybody's house or mail them to everybody's house who has property abutting the area where the herbicides will be sprayed. And they're going to start out on the western side of town near Victoria Road, or Victoria Drive, excuse me. And they're going to come all the way down and across Timber Swamp behind Pennington Lane. And they're going to go down across Toll Farm Road. This will go down across. If you follow the power line down after it crosses the interstate, it comes down to and across the rotary at Route 1 and Route 111. Route 11. 101 and Route 1, excuse me. It goes down to the beach substation, which is just behind Church Street. And there is another line that comes off of that that runs up the beach to the power substation that's up near the Northampton Town line. If you do not wish to have the herbicide sprayed near your property, you'll be receiving something, either a hanger on your door or something in the mail that'll tell you how you can apply by June 18th so that they will not spray in your area. So that's probably pretty important to folks for folks to know. This will be up on the town website shortly this week so that everybody can see it. And we'll have a copy posted on the bulletin board out front.
Very good.
That's it, sir.
Any questions for the town manager's report? Regina.
I have nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for your report, Mr. Walsh.
Thank you, sir.
Old business. Is there anything for old business?
I have old business.
Go ahead.
I'd like to bring up Chris Jacobs. I asked him to join us at the table here. And I would just like to say that I think it's time. I read his report and seeing what I'm talking about, the report about the sidewalks, it made a lot of sense to me, many of the things that he said, and I'm talking about the sidewalks uptown also. I would like to look at the sidewalks as one, you know, we need to work with the budgeting all as one, not just at the beach or uptown. So I like a lot of the things that you said. And I know that many other times when you've given us your department updates, it's been very apparent that you don't have the staff that you need. And I would like to make sure that we get it on the agenda, that be something that we discuss to bring forward in the coming year about adding some more staff at DPW. I think all 12 years I've been here, there's the same amount of people, and over and over and over again, his department has been hit, whether it was taking money out of it or not getting any new workers or whatever. And I think now that we have a department that's well set up with Mr. Jacobs and Jennifer Hale, I think that we can rest assured that they're going to do the right thing and we can listen to what they have to say. So I hope that we're going to put that on an agenda to open up this discussion. And I want to thank you again for the information that you gave us, particularly about the bidding process and everything that, you know, what you put together that for the line that goes across the marsh. It all makes a lot of sense. It's something that I was for right from the beginning. I just want to make sure it's the main thing that you have to face down there at DPW.
Yes, one of them.
So that's what I wanted to say.
Okay.
So I just was saying, Rusty, that we need to put on the agenda about having more employees down at DPW or doing something to expand the needs there.
Very good.
And I'd like to make that our, you know, a big discussion going into the budget season.
We can talk about it whenever you feel you got the time to
we'll talk about
address
it tomorrow morning and try to set
we can
a
have
schedule.
Something for our next meeting. If not, we'll a couple of meetings. It's not something that has to be done right away, but it should be looked at.
I would agree.
Okay. Your guys are doing a great job on the sidewalk right outside here, I noticed.
Yes.
So they are getting some good practice that they can use all uptown and make all these sidewalks accessible. Thank you. Thanks
Thank
for
you.
Waiting here no tonight.
Problem. Anything under old business?
Good night, Chris.
Yep.
Seeing nothing under old business, anything under new business?
I just want to say something real quick about it came up at public comment. But I just did want to bring it up tonight about that one biking, major, there's a lot of complaints. about the vehicles. So he told me he's going to move them, and I think he's moved the trailer. He said he's going to move the camper tomorrow.
Yep.
Hopefully he will, and we won't have to deal with it. But, I mean, hounded every day about it. So I just wanted to let the board know that it's definitely a huge issue in that neighborhood, that section of town.
I agree, and I heard quite a bit about it myself.
Yeah.
But I think the best way to deal with it when you're here with people, rather than approach people like him.
Well, he's confrontational toward me every day, no matter what. So I just happened to.
I don't know if you folks heard it.
Hold that up for till public comment, please.
Sometimes it's safer just to let Mr. Waltz do it.
Yeah.
It'll be looked at 7:00 tomorrow morning.
That's all we can ask.
And I think we're right on target with what happened. And it was pretty interesting to see him come down. It should always be that easy.
I know.
Any closing comments?
Make the motion to adjourn at 2209
I'm sorry. I recommend that the board make a motion to go into a non-public session under RSA 91-A:3(2)(c), reputation, and E, litigation, to discuss some matters.
Before that's done, this gentleman was here and he had some public comments, so if you'd like to have a final comment.
I'd just like to say, I don't know if you folks heard it, but I know Nancy heard it and the fire chief heard it. I went to open the door for him because he apparently was watching on television and he threatened me out in the hallway.
All right, Mr. Chairman, can we throttle back on this? Welch is violating no laws, parking his vehicles. It is a public concern. I have addressed that with the town manager.
That's fine.
He's attended many meetings here, and he's a citizen, and he's violating no laws. And I'm not a witness to any conversation, but that's not what we're about here tonight.
Correct. I didn't know what he had for conversation. So now I'll entertain the motion to go into non-public.
I'll make that motion to go non-public under 91.
I'll second it.
Roll call. Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Thank you.